Warning, Supernatural the Crossroads contains adult language and discussions. If you're easily offended, do not continue to listen.
As always, I am your host, Thomas Cowley. Joined with me today is Ryan Denton.
Hey, hey, hey.
And our buddy, Michael Flores, who's over on the side.
Hello. I'll do it for him. Hello.
So we want to thank you guys again for tuning in to us, catching us on Stitcher and iTunes, and hitting us up on Twitter, Facebook, all that stuff.
Yes. After the last couple episodes, man, my phone has been blowing up, dude.
Yeah, dude. I did not expect that.
No.
With our last episode about bloodlines, I expected conversation. Not what we got.
I did not expect to get that kind of conversation after that episode. You know,
a ton of feedback from people.
Yes,
not all of it good.
Not all of it good, but you know,
wait, feedback. All the feedback on our show was
fantastic.
On
well, Supernatural, I mean, bloodlines,
guys. Yeah. Mike thought the whole show, like he was thinking about not even airing because he thought we were bitching so much about the show. And it was like, I just felt like we were in
the right. I thought we were in the right.
We were in the right. I mean,
we didn't beat it up, and that was the important thing.
Well, when I went back and listened to the show, I was like, all right, this is all right. This is good. I think we gave it a fair shake. Like, it wasn't us just talking shit. You know, it was a fair shake. It was probably our most negative show.
Yeah, definitely.
But I think we gave it a fair shake, meaning we broke it down. Well, We broke down characters, and I think we did it justice.
I said that, you know, I felt like I would still watch it, and I wasn't like completely over the top. Thomas brought in the hammer and just destroyed it.
Well, nobody else wants to watch it, Ryan, because it got canceled.
Yeah. That's probably the biggest news in the week.
Well, you know that got canceled.
Is that really news?
No, not really. Sadly. But we'll break it down because later in the show, because the good thing is that even though they canceled, they passed on Bloodlines, which I think was probably a good move.
Yeah.
Honestly, if they got that much negative reaction, it probably was a good move. However, it's opened the doorway. They said there is a strong possibility that there'll still be another.
They're listening to our show and they're going to do. They're going to do Thomas's spinoff, dude.
Dude,
you better get royalties for that.
Dude, if they do that spinoff I had, I better see some checks in the mail.
Supposedly, there's some fan fiction that's already been doing ideas like that. Huh? Supposedly.
Well, let's all get in on that.
So stupid. There's an article that broke down like 9 of the best spinoff ideas that we would like to see as fans, which was actually a pretty good article. What we need to do is make it the discussion of the week. You know, question, and I actually posed that on Facebook and Google Plus. I put, "What spinoff ideas would you like to see?" And what we'll do when we break it down towards the end of the show is we'll talk about spinoffs, yada yada yada.
Sounds
It'll be
good.
Kind of fun.
Yep, and also coming up later at the end of the show, we have another interview with a very special guest. You're gonna have to correct me on his last name here, though. Theo Devaney.
Devaney.
That's what I thought it was.
He said Delaney, but with the V.
Okay, that's easy.
Theo Devaney.
The first question I asked him when I was on the phone with him was like, well, is it uppity? Are you upping it up like some actors do? Is it Devaney or Devaney? Devaney.
God.
Are we trying to foof it up? Like, we're trying to French it up a little bit?
I'm going to.
So we do have him later in the show. Thomas, we're kind of doing it backwards.
I know, we are.
Because last time we did Kim Rhodes right at the beginning.
Right, we did
this
it right
time
at the beginning,
we're going
right.
to do his availability has shifted him toward the end of the show. But that gives you guys all something to look forward to.
Exactly.
You get the regular show plus the bonus. Woo!
Woo! Huzzah!
Thomas won't be in the interview, sadly. He has to take off.
Thomas will be.
Thomas will be.
All right, not Thomas. Sorry. Ryan Denton. Yeah.
He doesn't know who I am.
Yeah.
I've been on this show since the beginning. He still doesn't. does not know my name.
Guy with a beard in corner.
Yeah, I got another commitment. But yeah, I look forward to it. Hopefully,
I'm just gonna set the
set the tone.
Yeah, set the tone here. Okay. Right. Listen, you know what, guys? We've already had people say, "Well, you got a lot to top with the Kim Rhodes interview." We're not gonna try to top the Kim Rhodes interview.
No.
The way we connected with her was so unexpected. We had chemistry with her. All three of us had great chemistry with Kim. And who knows? We may end up having great chemistry with Theo. We don't know yet. Yeah. However, I'm not going to try to duplicate that. You never try to duplicate a success. It needs to happen organically and by accident. You can't plan it.
Can't plan it.
Yeah. No. For those of you who don't know, Theo is Crowley's
son.
Son from the most recent episode. Yep. So, yeah.
And there's a lot of big things, which we'll get into that.
I think he's a big future there.
I think so, too.
Yeah, that's going to be interesting. So I think with that, we're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to get into our recap. So we'll be right back.
Winchesters were supposed to be tough.
Find the blade. Kill Abaddon. Leave me a promise first. When I call you, and I will call, you come find me and use the blade on me.
Stitcher review. You can help us. Thomas, I don't know if you guys even know about this, but on Stitcher, we have most of our listenership is on iTunes and Stitcher.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And in order for us to keep growing as a show, what the listeners can do, in fact, you guys can tell people in your everyday life, people you may see, is leave us a review on Stitcher. All you do on Stitcher is you go to the app or on your computer and just look for the little comic bubble, little talking bubble. You click on review, you press submit. It takes a couple minutes.
I mean, it could even be awesome, guys.
Yeah.
Just say that. There
just say awesome.
Ryan Denton told me to just say awesome.
This is my review.
If someone does that, that'd be awesome.
Yes. Oh,
so
awesome.
Leave us a review. Help us keep growing. I did a little bit of a bribe, but listen, that's what someone said. I said this on the Twitter, and they said I'm bribing them, but it's true. If we keep growing, if we can get our rankings to 10 or 5, we are going to be able to make a phone call to Jensen or Jeremy. It'll be very simple to get an interview with them because they'll see our ranking. I'll just send that to them, like, bam, check it out.
That's the goal, guys. Get us to that point where we can get Jensen and Jared on the show.
Then we can play F, Mary, Kill with them.
Exactly.
Are we going to do it with us?
That might
be awkward.
That might be a little weird.
Carry on my wayward son. There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.
This is Michael Flores, and this is just your reminder that you can follow us on Facebook. Go to facebook.com/supernaturalthecrossroads. Also, you can find us on Twitter. Go to twitter.com/crossroadsspn and get involved with the show.
Whenever you play that music, Ryan's like jamming out off to the side.
I do this every time, right before we start with the intro music, and anytime you come back with music, I I dance and stuff because it gets me loose.
Oh, my God. All right, guys. So here we go with our recap of last episode, King of the Damned. Cassiel captures one of Metatron's angels and asks Sam and Dean for help with the interrogation. Dean eagerly accepts, which doesn't go unnoticed by Sam. Meanwhile, Abaddon demands Crowley help her kill Sam and Dean. When he refuses, she reveals her shocking bargaining chip. Also, Castiel gets a meeting with Gadriel. Now, when I read that the first time, I was like, that's a lot of stuff to get in.
That's a lot of plot points, man.
That's a lot of crap.
Yeah.
So, with the end of the season, I'm like, well, are they going to try and wrap anything up here? I didn't think they would, honestly.
Oh.
I thought there was enough here to go into even season 10. You know, I felt like with Carver's idea of this is a branching,
right,
overarching season.
So what you're saying is you didn't see the Dean predatoring freaking Abaddon up in the air with the first blade.
No, I did not see the fatality.
Dude, that totally reminded me of the scene in Predator where Predator lifts Carl Weathers up in the air with his blades. Dude, that's what that was.
Yeah.
It was awesome. Yes, and I use the word awesome.
I was shocked. It's super. I haven't got a shock like that in a while. Kevin dying was, oh, what the hell? But the shock that he actually killed Abaddon, I was shocked. Like, I didn't say anything.
You're
for
shocked.
A good, yeah, it was like a good 30 seconds, dude, of me not saying anything. I'm like, what the? Because first I was so enamored with how dope the scene was, first off.
It
the
was
scene
very
was,
cool.
I mean, dude.
We've been waiting for that,
It was sweet, dude.
Okay, I already said this off air. I'm going to be the bad guy this week on that.
What a hater's going to hate.
While I thought it was cool, at the same time, I was like, Star Wars? Like, when he's like got the Force on the on the blade, I'm like, okay, cool in concept, but like...
I felt that
was too much Star Wars in a way.
Do you think Abaddon was?
They were trying
to be like Wampa, and he was. He was hanging upside down because that would have made it better.
Have you not watched Supernatural in the last 9 years? That's what they do is Star Wars references.
I know they do, so we've done them on this show.
The first thing I thought was, dude, he just hothed it, dude.
Oh my God!
I mean, first thought I had was like exactly what you just said. If he was upside down, I think it would have made it even that much better.
I think you couldn't do that without like some kind of copyright issue.
George would be on the phone.
I was excited.
Disney,
dude.
Now.
Oh, Disney, yeah.
I was excited about the death of Abaddon, but at the same time, I do feel like it was a little too soon.
Premature.
I think they could have. I look at it a couple different ways. They could have dragged it out another two episodes to the season finale. This gets me hyped to like, okay, if they've already killed Abaddon, then what do they have planned for the last two episodes then?
Yeah.
Because that's how I looked at it. I'm like, okay, if they just did away with the main villain in the second to last episode, or the third to last episode of the season, it just makes me think, what do they have planned next?
It's got to be. I mean, obviously, it's Crowley. It's centered. I mean, obviously, he's going to be the main focus the last
couple. But
with Metatron.
But is he?
With Metatron.
But is he? I don't want to jump into Crowley quite yet, but I mean, they had the opportunity to kill him, and they didn't.
They didn't,
He's been more, again, we've said this before, he's been more useful than he's been,
he really has.
To their
really
entire
has.
Thing. I mean, without Crowley this season, they wouldn't have the first blade, the Mark of Cain.
Abaddon
would screwed them over.
She wouldn't be dead. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I agree.
Well, dude, Abaddon dying just, we pissed away all of our ideas that we've had all season.
Oh, honestly, dude.
Yeah.
Like, I was
flushed
the
down the
thing,
toilet.
Is we had, like, all these ideas. Was there going to be battles between, demons and other demons and angels and demons? And it's, like, all this, like, grandiose stuff.
Well, dude.
And while it was cool that the way she died, it still was, like, we could have done a lot more, I thought. With her as a character,
she could have been utilized a little more,
especially because like most of this season we don't even see her. Like the second half, I'd say we see her and Crowley. Like, oh, the game's on. Next episode, we see her. The game's over. So
honestly, dude, I think that now that they've killed her, she was just a means to an end, dude. Like, yes, she was a cool character. They needed her in order for Dean to come out on his own as, as the new
king. She was a catalyst.
That's pretty much what I think she was used for. That's why they brought her back, even though she died already last year. They brought her back so that Dean has a reason to become, the Cain reincarnate. That's the entire purpose.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if she was intended to die in season 8 with Henry Winchester, but they're like, well, we can do something with this.
Right.
And they built off that idea. So then they kind of just wrapped her up.
That's why they let.
But I do feel that that was a missed opportunity, which could have been really.
You know
cool.
what? I agree. However, they have more characters in the last two seasons than they've ever had. Like with and then not characters meaning like stop and go. I mean ongoing revolving storylines with different
they
characters.
They do have quite a list.
And you know what? They need to kill people. I hate to say it. They killed Kevin. They're not going to kill Castiel. Okay, he's in season 10. They just announced
he's
it.
Too big.
But they need to start killing people. I hate to see it happen. But the worst thing as a writer, I mean myself, when I write, well, the hardest thing for me to do is kill characters. But you just have to do it.
I mean,
you
let's be honest. They just need to kill Sam off. Let's be honest. Just get rid of him.
That's rude, man.
No, I mean, I know what you're saying with the how hard it is to kill characters, but at the same time, you know, while I love Castiel and I know the fans love him, when you have someone who's that well loved, it mm-hmm. can hurt your writing ability because you can't remove this character.
You can't get rid of him.
I mean, they've tried that twice now. Season 5, he was gone for a period, like an episode, and season 7.
Yeah. Well, that's the problem they had with that television show Homeland. Damian Lewis, phenomenal talent. Holy hell, dude.
Yeah.
Get him in Supernatural, please. Phenomenal talent. But, dude, spoiler, guys, tune off for about 15 seconds. They kill him at the end of season 3. And fans were like, I started watching the show for you.
Yeah.
And what they had to do was, or Damian Lewis released his own press release and said, guys, the way I look at it is I was hindering the show. Yeah. They couldn't move on with my storyline, and they had the only option for this show to continue to grow and not get stale was for them to kill me.
Well, look at it this way. Walking Dead doesn't have that problem. They axe people off. They don't care if you like them or not.
Right.
The thing is, my mentality has always been take something away while people still want it.
Yeah.
Rather than give it to them so much that it becomes nothing.
It becomes
like
stale.
Their dad dying in season 2. We miss him like crazy.
Right? Dude, I want him back.
He was an amazing character for that show. And we still want him back. But if they had that drag on and on, like you said, the show couldn't move forward. They couldn't go to hell and make deals.
And that's the thing with Bobby. With Bobby, I think, you know what, served his point. I hate saying that. I love him. But I know there's like a petition going on bringing him back.
Yeah.
You know? I don't think it's a good idea.
Just let him be done.
I absolutely love Jim Beaver. Love him. But you know what? I think it's a bad idea to bring the guy back. You need to kill characters. Need to stick with
them. They need to stay dead.
Yeah. Honestly, Bobby might have been my favorite character at one point.
He was great.
Oh,
he was
agree.
Phenomenal.
Yeah.
And I completely agree. If you bring him back, that only hurts it.
It
and that's one thing
it.
I feel
and
like
it takes away from the death.
Exactly. Yeah. It makes the death not matter as much. Yeah. And I think that's one issue they've run into with Castiel is that he's died, quote,
well,
so
you
many
get
times
into, you get
that
into
you're never
going
to believe it.
You get into the whole Marvel comics thing where it's like, oh, we're gonna kill this character, and then a month later they come back and it's like nobody, when someone dies there's no impact there. You know, when someone, like I said, when someone dies in like a show like Walking Dead, it's like, holy shit, that person's never coming back. I'm never gonna see that character again. So it's like you guys said, it's a lot more impactful.
Well, I mean, with the death thing, they had an opportunity in this episode to kill a major character, and that was Crowley. When he's just sitting there literally like paralyzed,
right?
You know, and that was one question, actually. I just thought of this. Wasn't Abaddon like completely unable to move when she was shot, and Crowley could like move his arm?
I don't know.
Or was that because she was shot in the head?
I really don't know.
In episode 3, season 5.
I know. Thomas, dude, the Bloodlines episode, Let Leash, the troll.
Yes,
the troll Thomas.
The inner troll.
I'm just asking questions. That's all I'm doing.
You're not allowed to.
I'm just joking. I'm joking. Yeah. I don't know about Ryan. But
I'm dead serious.
But they had a chance to kill Crowley, and they didn't do it.
That's what I'm saying. He was laying right there, couldn't
easy
move,
kill.
And they could have killed him, and they just walked right past him. So, you know what? I'm kind of confused because Sam wanted him dead, and maybe they gave him a pass because he did basically save them and gave them the chance to kill
Abaddon. On
a
platter,
And at the same time, this goes back to my theory, whereas because I tweeted this out, would it be okay at this point for the Winchesters to kill Crowley?
Mm-hmm.
Will we as an audience and viewers be okay with it now? Because or will we kind of be kind of disappointed that they killed this guy? And the first thing someone tweeted out was, I believe his name is at HR Zone. He said, Crowley has done way too many things for me to ever forgive him. But that's then. As the trials has exercised him and made him a different person. Going back to what I said about 4 or 5 shows ago, what has Crowley done this season since he's been, you know, forgiven or the trials have washed him clean and he's been face to face with his humanity? What has Crowley done that deserves death? I mean, if you're looking at this from a Catholic standpoint, which this is what this show's written from,
right.
I mean, he's been forgiven. His sins have been washed clean. He's been face to face with his humanity. So he does, in my eyes, and I think to most listeners, audiences, I don't think he deserves death. And I think they're going to keep playing with that, at least until we see what he has in store. If he indeed has something in store for Dean, then we may say, okay, this is the same old evil Crowley playing at his game, because he's definitely playing at something.
He's playing a long game.
There's a game there. Yeah.
But like you said, the question is it something negative with Dean, or now that his son's been brought back into the picture,
so
is it going to change more to a positive? You know, what's going to happen with his son's character now that he's been introduced?
Let me ask this. Was I the only one that found it a little weird that it was so easy for Abaddon to go back in time? Oh, there's a sigil I'm just going to use, and now I'm back in time. Like,
it was, but it wasn't. I agree, it was kind of convenient, but isn't that what she does? Doesn't she travel time?
She
did that before. How did she get to?
Because their grandfather.
He made the sigil.
She followed him,
and she just walked.
She didn't do anything.
Oh, so now she had a sigil all of a sudden.
Yeah.
I call it the Dr. Emmett Brown sigil.
Yeah, so dumb.
Yeah, I mean, I agree, Ryan. I felt that was a little like.
Convenient.
What? But I mean, it worked.
Yeah, it
in
did.
A way. It didn't break its knee. So
I'm willing to. I'm willing to swallow it. You know, for the most part.
Let's be honest. I'm Thomasing it. Okay. I'm nitpicking it a little bit. Okay.
I'm willing to swallow that. However, I mean, what's next? I mean, you have to. When you do something like that, you need to be careful, because now you've allowed time travel to be acceptable in this universe officially. Not just by accident, or like what the Winchesters did, because by going to the West. If you have someone that can just as simple as making a sigil, why aren't they going to go Terminator style on it and now go kill John Winchester before he ever gave birth?
That's what I was looking at. I was like,
gave his semen.
I was going to say, she knows that they're after the first blade. Why wouldn't she just go back in time and just get the first blade?
Like, well, she's dead. She's dead, Ryan.
I mean, that is a...
Shut up.
That's the whole conundrum you open up when you have time travel as an option. It's like, well, why go back to solve your current problem when you could just go back to solve the problem?
Right.
The,
time travel is a sticky bitch.
It's a bad idea in a lot of ways, because also it used to be like only angels could do it, and it's not... Like, Cassiel's like, oh, it's not as easy or as linear as
now
you think
it is. Now
it's easy.
It's a sigil.
You know? And now it's like, yeah, we just do some drawings.
Yeah.
We're good.
We'll do some finger painting on this
finger
door.
Finger painting on the wall. Fuck it. Time machine.
Well, the good thing about that, I do find it exciting a little bit about the time travel a little bit, is time travel, when you mess with time, it's always scary.
Yeah.
Not because it's going to mess up. Let's take away the writing aspect of it and like the many issues it could create. But look at... What the first thing Sam and Dean said, like, dude, you cannot mess with time.
Yeah,
right.
You
know, yeah, that was
his words.
Thing.
He says you can't mess with.
You can't change like one thing; it'll have a ripple effect. That'll change everything.
What was it? Oh, the whole ripple effect.
Yeah.
That's what he said. And like the whole ripple effect. And the first thing I thought was, dude, you guys have come back from the dead time and time again.
Yeah.
And I thought that was going to be a major mishap in writing, but Crowley fixed it.
Yeah. Essentially, well, I mean, if you think about it, essentially, that's basically what they did, is they brought him back from the dead, because if he gets on that ship, he dies anyways.
Right.
So,
well, then you have the whole issue of, did he ever get on the ship in the first place, because he went through time.
He went through time, right.
Yeah, but you said, Mike, because they're sitting there, like, you can't change one thing. And the first thing I thought, I was like, bullshit, you have changed so much stuff. But like you said, Crowley, you know, paid attention to that, luckily.
Yeah.
But I mean, I felt that could have been
that was the writers telling us to simmer down.
Yeah, exactly.
It was.
we know. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Simmer down.
Although that could be, I think, a gateway into you. If you change something, what can happen? I think that could be something down the line.
Do an episode. 10, do an episode where they where like something
where
changed.
Maybe a story arc where if you go back in time to change one thing. And then what does that cause?
They've got a cool angle here with Gavin now that, yes, he did not get on the boat. So what has that changed? So then there could be a whole story arc, like you said, where it's about him and what's changed now because he didn't die in that boat, which could be an that would be really cool.
And this is, once again, agreeing with you, Ryan. This is once again Carver living up to his plan of action that he set at the Comic-Con a year and a half ago now, where he said, unlimited possibilities in the storyline world. And this is yet another one that's opened. Some people may say, hey, he's opening up too much possibilities, but they're not like open-ended, like where you need to know the ending of the story. However, he's opening them up, and if need be, let's say they decide not to use Gavin, they can close it with one or two episodes.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
However, if people end up liking this guy, they can like, hey, listen, guys, let's keep using him in season 10, which, you know, I talked to, you know, we haven't talked to Gavin yet, but I talked to him in a pre-interview, and first thing he said is he can't talk about anything.
Right.
He's like, definitely a cool character.
Well, you're not going to bring a character like that back, or you're not going to bring a character in there for one episode, then make it a point as saying, hey, don't mess with time, you know, the whole ripple effects crowd. You're not going to do that for no reason. There is a specific reason why they put it right in your face and said, hey, time travel, ripple effect, no-no Crowley.
Exactly.
There was a reason for it.
Right. Well, I mean, also, I doubt they would tell an actor, don't tell anybody about the one episode you have. We don't have any plans, but don't tell anybody.
Right.
You know, so it's a good sign.
I told him to breathe once heavy if he will be in the next episode. Don't say a word.
Confirm or deny.
Just give me one breath.
So, another thing that I thought was, I don't want to use the word goofy, but the whole Angel headquarter war room thing, and the whole Angel bar, I was like, okay, when that scene started with the Angel bar, I was just kind of like, where the hell is this going? Like, what?
Yeah,
I mean, what is this? I totally thought that guy was a total turd.
Oh yeah, I
think that was the point.
Exactly.
Well, yeah, that was the whole point. It was just funny.
The Angel bar, I kind of was like, all right, whatever. I mean, everyone needs a drink, although. When Castiel
is that what it was though? That's kind of I put that in the show and it's more of a question.
I honestly
was
think
that
it was
an angel bar because a bunch of angels just chilling. It seemed like
they're all hanging out. So at least they have a common meeting ground.
Angels in a bar.
The bar didn't throw me as much as like when they walked into that bunker and it was like all of a sudden part of the Avengers. And I'm like, okay,
that man is playing.
Have we been busy?
That guy is playing Galaga.
So stupid. I was like, how long have the angels been at this? You know, I would like to have known like a little bit of a.
A big jump. Although I've accepted one thing they've done though. If you guys look back at season 9, one thing they've done is they when it comes to Castiel's storyline, every time we see him, a lot has happened because he's not in
every episode.
And I think a lot more time has gone by within the storyline.
Obviously, right? Yeah, but I was just like, that did throw me.
It just they had a whole freaking working map of the entire world.
Like, you think I
just thought that was I just thought it was really funny. Like, it was.
I don't know. Sometimes I do because Castiel like didn't know how basic things work.
Tastes like molecules.
Exactly. He's struggling with the concept of peanut butter and jelly.
Yeah,
and now they can.
Now
like,
he's got a war room.
Work.
He's got General Patton's war room, you know? Like, come on.
So stupid.
No, I mean.
General Patton's war room.
I mean, so they had.
As long as he doesn't give any William Wallace type speeches before the battle.
They can take my life, but they can never take my wings.
They already did weight shit.
Oh, yeah. I thought it was funny. And then, you know, the whole interrogation thing, I thought it was cool how they did that. Because you're like, oh, it's just going to be Dean beating this guy up.
Right. I'm like, we've seen that before.
We've seen that a million times. And then they went a whole nother route with it, which was freaking great, actually.
Yeah. They played on the small man complex.
Yes,
to a T. Like, we're going to get this guy to talk by just talking shit about him and making him have to prove himself.
Yeah.
Dude, you know what? It seems far-fetched, but I know people that way. Oh, dude, you suck. There's no way you've ever done that before.
No, I seriously have, man.
I swear, dude. I swear.
You got time and date and detail? Oh.
Yeah. So it made sense. But you know what's funny, though, is I actually got tweeted. I forgot the exact Twitter account name. I apologize. But someone tweeted me. I had no idea, but it's a thing on the internet where I guess there were some fans saying that the writers used this interrogation scene to actually poke fun at the fans. You know, the fans who think they're befriended Jared Padalecki or Jensen because they talk to them once in a while on Twitter or they post on his Facebook wall from time to time.
Honestly, you know what, though? When I was watching that, I got that.
Did you?
I did. I totally got that.
I didn't get that.
I was thinking
I could see it.
Yeah.
I didn't get that.
The only reason I was thinking that is because I know people who are like that. Mm-hmm. And because I go to like conventions and stuff all the time, I know people are like, oh, I talked to, you know, and they start calling them like they know them.
We're best bros.
Yeah.
Bro.
And it's
dropping.
Yeah. I totally got that out of that. That's funny.
Well, see, I didn't get that when I was watching it, but then when someone tweeted that to me, I was like, oh, okay, I can see that. And someone said there were some fans that were actually upset. And then the person I was speaking to about this on the internet said, how do you guys feel about it? And I said, the way I look at it is this. This is all I have to say about it. If they were, in fact, making fun of the fans, I don't care. You know why? Because they make fun of themselves all day long. They make fun of their acting career. Yeah. They make fun of their resumes. They make fun of the way they talk.
They did a whole episode making fun of themselves.
The way I look at it is they make fun of themselves. So if they want to poke fun now at the fans a little bit, who cares? I mean, isn't the entire like Supernatural like fan fiction made fun of in the episodes with the remember with the whole woman that married Sam that tricked, did they get married? Yeah, that tricked Sam into getting married to her. Wasn't that entire making fun of the fan fiction? Well, the Comic Cons, the convention fans?
The Supernatural convention season 5, you know, that whole thing is about making fun of us. And honestly, if you can't take a joke, like, come on.
Yeah. And now, if they were all uppity about it and they never made fun of themselves, then I can be like, okay. But you know what? They make fun of themselves. It's like when William Shatner, like a few years back, like 10 years ago, got on Saturday Night Live and made fun of the Star Trek fans. And, you know, he did a whole skit like, hey, you losers, get a life. You know? Dude, William Shatner makes fun of himself more than anybody. His entire career is pretty much him making fun of himself at this point.
Have you seen Boston Legal at all?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So if you can, the way I look at it, if you can poke fun of yourself, then you can poke fun at others as well. Yes. As long as it's within, you know,
right.
In good, not good. What's the name? What's the word of it? In poking fun. I can't think of the right word.
You're an idiot.
Dude, I'm tired. Exhausted. But
would you guys have rather seen Evil Dean actually like go crazy on this dude?
I've seen it too many times.
I have an idea, honestly.
I've seen it too many times, and we've seen him, it's called Dean, and he was torturing people in hell, so we'll do it again. I'm glad they didn't go that route. Although this guy was a ding dong, I wouldn't mind him getting punched around a little bit just because he was a stupid character.
He didn't deserve to die, I think.
People have said Dean has back when he was the hell interrogator, whatever, he enjoyed it supposedly, but we've never actually seen him enjoy it. Did we see him? We didn't actually see him like enjoy it with a smirk on his face. Like it was almost painful enjoyment.
He enjoys it in that classic Dean, I'm angry about this enjoyment way.
See, I would have liked the new Mark of Cain Dean, where he actually has bloodlust. He never had bloodlust. Sadistic. Yeah. I would have liked to see him interrogate rather than that whole cheesy line, which I'm okay with. It was funny, but it would have gone more hand in hand with the Dean we know now. The last few episodes, it would have said a lot more about his character besides just beating the shit out of Abaddon's corpse. I think it would have. Oh my God, he just butchered this dude.
Honestly, guys, I think, and it may just be what I would have wanted to happen, but I could see Dean being the one who actually snuck back in there and killed him.
Yeah.
I mean, we hear them say the last we saw of him, but Sam's not keeping eyes on Dean at all times. Dean has lied to Sam repeatedly.
Yeah.
And if he's getting affected by the blade like that, he could easily go back in there.
We never find out. We didn't find out who stabbed him.
No, we didn't. So it could still be him.
It could still be him.
Well, dude, he's all Smeagol-ish now too. Like he's so Smeagol-ish, dude. Like when that first blade was on the dashboard, he wanted that blade in his hand. He wanted the precious.
I hope he doesn't start losing his hair. Then he won't be hot anymore.
Dean isn't hot anymore at all.
This show is not good.
He's completely became the Gollum, and not the Gollum that they introduced last season, but the actual Gollum from Lord of the Rings. That's what he looks like. That's not cool.
I would really like to see Dean be the one who did that. I mean, we saw him just murder a dude because they were killing people.
Yeah.
You know, and while this guy wasn't evil, I think that would say a lot about how the blade is affecting him.
Yeah.
Because Abaddon makes sense. You want her dead. He's angry at her, obviously. If he just goes and kills a guy who's not even a bad dude, really, who's chained up to a chair, that speaks volumes compared to just killing one of your major bad guys. I'd like to see that happen. Plus, I don't know. I mean, I didn't really buy into the idea that there's an angel inside Castiel's, you know, group that's a double agent. I don't know. I didn't buy into that. Maybe because Gadriel's...
Why didn't you buy into it?
I don't know. I think that's too much for angels in a way. They're soldiers.
Too much for them, dude. Look what they've done, dude. They're deceitful sons of bitches, dude.
They lie
in a lot of ways.
But...
In a lot of ways, it's like Jack Sparrow, dude. Like, you know, you want to you trust the people who are dishonest, because dishonest people you always expect to be dishonest.
Right.
The demons, you know where you are with them. You know where you stand with them. With the angels, you, because they have the name angels attached to them, you automatically think, oh, they're angels and they're good, they're fluffy and they love us and they're gonna take care of us. But instead. You get, and sometimes you get the Care Bears, the Care Bear version. Sometimes you get the evil version, who wants to control and rule, or the people with no emotion. Because a lot of these people have, they're almost like Vulcan. They think more about logic. The angels kind of go where the wind blows them, and whatever they think is logical at that point. You know, if they think it's logical to hang out with Metatron and that they want to get back to heaven where it feels good, then I would see that these angels, as weak as they are, with little or no integrity of what has been established with a lot of these angels, I could easily see them being swayed. Easily.
Well, that's what I'm saying, though. Is like you said, they go just where the wind blows, essentially. Yeah. And I don't see them... exactly doing the double agent role very well. I see them being told, okay, Metatron's right, so I'll just go and do A.
Mm-hmm.
Or Castiel's right, so I'll do B. I don't see them being like, Metatron's right, so I'm going to pretend to obey Castiel. Because that's like a whole conflicting two different generals. How did they deal with that? The angels have been shown they cannot make decisions on their own. So I think a double agent role is a little bit much. I don't know. And I also think that Metatron's smarter than that.
Yeah.
To blatantly kill one of the guys that you sent out, who's clearly an idiot, to tell them about the portal in the first place?
Yes, unless it's a trap.
Unless it's a trap, which...
It's a trap!
It's got to be, right?
Right.
Or if Dean killed that guy as well, then it makes less sense for there to be a double agent. That could just throw them all off. Yeah. And Dean makes everyone go down a road that was wrong, and then they get screwed over for that.
Unless it's as simple as this guy just being a complete oaf, doof, idiot, and he spilled the beans. And then someone killed him for it, which is what we
saw. Could be that, too. But, you know, I don't know. I guess I'd like to see the whole Dean going much darker route. So I don't want to believe in the angels.
Take
double
it
agent.
Easy over here, Dark Side.
No, I like it. I want to see that.
I agree with you. Like, I would have liked. I would have think it would have been better, and the stakes would have been risen that much more. If Dean's the one who actually went in there secretly and killed the guy, but then pawned it off on an angel.
Exactly.
I think that would have been cooler, but maybe the audience isn't quite ready for it yet, and maybe the writers think that. Like, listen, dude, we don't want to see Dean scraping the bottom of the barrel until the season finale.
Yeah,
maybe.
See, I'm not completely ready for full-blown dark side Dean yet.
I think it needs to be a process, and it has been a process, but he has killed Abaddon. The entire point of him getting the Mark of Cain and looking for the First Blade was to kill Abaddon. He's done. His mission when it comes to the Mark of Cain is finished.
Technically speaking, what about Crowley?
Well, hold on.
He can be killed by other means.
That wasn't the original reason. So now that the Mark of Cain, the reason or the catalyst for him doing this and selling his soul in a sense was to kill Abaddon, now what does he have to live for? Is he going to keep getting Smingalish? Is he going to get more and more down that road that he needs that First Blade? He's going to start strapping it on his leg like Lorenzo Lamas from The Renegade? Like, is he in fact going to be doing that? I mean, he straight up told Sam. Sam said what? I think we need to store this, put it in the same place, safe. And what did he say?
No.
No, I mean,
dude, he wouldn't play coy about it. It was no like, no, I think it's better. It was no.
Yeah. I mean, I agree. I think that he's way too invested in that power. He likes how it feels too much.
Oh, for sure.
I don't see him getting rid of it immediately, which I hope Cain comes back as a result to try and get it or something like that.
Try to take it back from him.
Did you hear that actor got cast in another TV show?
No, dude. Come
why
on.
Do you say this? Like, why do you
dude.
Kill us?
And
like,
you get on
they
me.
Just, they just no. They just announced that Timothy O, whatever his name is, I don't know his last name. He got cast in as a regular in some NBC show. So who knows? Now, if he's just a guest, like pops in five times, then they could still do it. I don't think it'll be a contract issue. An issue contractually, but you know they could make it work, especially if they already wrote him in this. They can't just not have him in it again.
Mike's just the bearer of bad news, dude.
I read, dude. I got to stay up on the supernatural world. We do do a show called Supernatural Crossroads.
Oh, I thought we were just goofing off.
Well, hey, really fast, kind of backtracking a little bit with Sam and Dean. He pretty much deceived Sam again. You know, he actually sent him down another path intentionally.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you think this is because, you know, I don't think it's about protecting Sam at this point.
No.
Do you think it was more or less that he just didn't want to have a witness to his bad?
He wanted no one to see how dark he was going to get with that.
Well, you know what? Yeah, that's what I think, too. I think it's like, hey, I don't want to witness. It's like when I wake up in the middle of the night to eat, like, some cereal, and I know I shouldn't. Like, and I get embarrassed when my girlfriend wakes up, and she's like, you eating at 2 in the morning? I'm like, I'm hungry.
You're hungry. You should be happy that you're eating cereal.
What a glutton.
Because for me, that'd be an entire cake.
Well,
at 2
dude,
in the morning.
Don't you feel if someone caught you, wouldn't you feel slightly ashamed that you woke up?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, you feel a little ashamed.
I feel ashamed for a lot of things I do. So 2 in the morning cereal isn't that big a taboo.
Well, when you put peanut butter in it because you love peanut butter too much, I mean, yeah, it becomes a 3,000 calorie midnight snack.
I don't know if you guys, know, but 3,000 calories at midnight, that's good for you. When you go lay back down and just let it just go straight.
If it's protein, perhaps, but but all carbs and fat, probably not.
It's great for you.
This week's food tip.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, I definitely think that was, Sam, I don't want you to see this. I don't want you to see how much I want to screw over Abaddon and Crowley. He might have killed Crowley, too, had Sam not been there.
My question to you, Thomas and Ryan, first off, are you questioning why Castiel may not have interfered? Like, usually Castiel will say what. Do you remember how Castiel almost didn't like Sam when he was doing demon blood, drinking demon blood?
Yep.
Remember, he was very distrustful. Yes,
yeah.
He avoided him, very distrustful of the guy. Yes, he was new. He didn't really quite know them yet, but he had a connection with Dean immediately. With Sam, it was kind of like, dude, stay away
from
me.
Well, at that time, though, wasn't Dean still the vessel for...
Dean was the vessel for Michael at that point.
And Sam was the vessel for Lucifer.
And that's why.
But do you find it odd... Or do you think it's almost like, I'm going to stay out of your way. I have faith that you know what you're doing. Because he hasn't even tried to interfere. He just told Sam that little wink, wink, hey, keep an eye on him.
I think it's a couple of things. I think it's once, you know, Castiel lost his way with trying to become God, with taking in the Leviathans.
Yeah.
Him and Dean had a real big falling out kind of thing.
Yeah.
And they've never really recovered
There's been no reconnection.
Exactly.
There.
I think part of that
I think they've
reconnected, but it hasn't been the same.
Right. Yeah.
And I think that when you have something like that, you don't really want to tell your friend how to live their life when you were guilty of some horrific, you know, problems before. And I also think when he was doing that towards Sam, that was like they hadn't had somebody deliberately become a better vessel for the devil kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And he also was more like, I'm with you guys in this. We're, you know, soldiers in the trenches together. This, I think at this point, after not wanting to essentially step on Dean's toes by being a friend, like, hey, you shouldn't drink that, said the recovering alcoholic. I think it was that. Plus, with the whole war, he's got a lot more on his side now. And his story for the first time is a personal one. Whereas, you know, Dean wanted to kill Dick Roman because of Bobby. And that was all he cared about.
You want
to
kill Dick.
You want to hit that dick, dude.
Oh, Jesus.
I think Castiel's got Metatron in the same sight. Castiel's pissed at him, so he's focusing on that. And he feels like it's not his place. He's got other issues at the time.
That's kind of what I'm getting. It's kind of like he disapproves, but he's also saying, hey, listen, dude, we've been through
he's
so much.
He's staying out of it. Yeah. He's just kind of
every time he gets involved, you know, something bad happens.
People die!
Exactly.
I think in these next two episodes, though, I think coming up, I think we're going to see, like, I think we're going to see Castiel might want to interfere a little more.
I would hope just so.
Like I said, dude, the Mark of Cain is over for him. Like, the reason
he's
for
gonna
him,
wanna interfere.
He needs to pass the mark to some homeless dude. Just be like, hey, listen, I'm done with the mark, dude.
The next serial killer.
Listen, you see more of the, I got to get rid of this shit. Dude, it's like a black cloud over me. Here you go, homeless guy. Like, give him like $100 with it.
Hey, you look stable and your life isn't terrible. Take this from me, why don't you?
Dude, just get rid of that shit, dude.
I think Castiel will start interfering. We'll start intervening a little bit more.
Thomas's face when I said homeless guy, you were like shaking your head like you agreed that all of a sudden, wait a second.
Wait a minute here.
I think Castiel will start intervening a little bit more now that like you said, the whole reason
it's over.
So
I'm surprised Sam. I know Sam. Like we said this last week, Sam, you know, looks like his world is over all the time, and that someone's just shit in his cereal. I'm surprised even him. He's like, no, like you need to lock this bitch up. Like you're done with this thing.
I don't know. I feel like Sam's kind of getting. He's so fed up with Dean's lies at this point.
Right.
He cares about him because he's his brother, but at the same time, he's like, you know, if you're going to – you sleep in the bed you make. at this point.
Yeah.
You know? And that's kind of the vibe I'm getting. I think ultimately when it comes down to it, Sam will be like, hey, Dean, come back from the darkness.
Right. Well, he usually is the one who's been snapping him out of it.
Yeah. He has.
You know, which
Dean, what do you do? Dean, you need to drop the blade.
I think that's something they're trying to drive home, that point.
Yeah.
He's the one who snaps him out of it.
He loses himself in it.
Yeah. And then Sam's the one who brings him back.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah. And I think also it's like he doesn't want to get in Dean's face about it, because Dean will be the kind of guy who's like, well, then screw you. I'm taking the blade. I'm going on my own.
Yeah, dude.
I'm turning off my phone.
He needs to be his support at that point when he's in that bloodlust mode.
Yeah.
Sam needs to be his support from about a good 100 yards in case he decides to get all Kane about it and like chop his head off or something.
You can't tell Dean this is what you need to do, so start doing it.
Yeah.
You have to appeal to what Dean knows he wants without saying it.
Yeah.
That whole subconscious emotional crap.
All right. I guess we're kind of ready for final thoughts, right? Did we cover everything?
I think so, yeah.
Oh, wait. Castiel and Gudriel.
Yeah.
Like, I can sum that up real quick.
Okay.
Okay.
Wow.
No, we're ready.
I've never had you guys get that excited about me. No, I think that whole scene there was totally necessary. And the reason being is the last episode, and they did it actually in the preview, like, oh, what's happening in the last... They showed Metatron almost screwing over Gudriel. You know,
right.
I know how the story ends.
Yeah, I know how the story ends. Blah blah blah. Well, was Sam and Dean part of your vision or whatever? And that was necessary for what I think. You know, we covered a couple episodes ago, saying, you know, I think Gadriel's getting ready to make the flip.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and even Castiel says, you know, those weren't my men. You know, I wasn't trying to. You know, it wasn't. This was a mutual. It wasn't a sting operation.
Yeah,
we met in good faith.
Yeah,
and I think
it was like no blasters, no blasters. Exactly. It was like that. Yeah, it was Wooler, dude, trying to stop the fight in the cantina.
So dumb. But no, I felt like that scene was necessary because we're going to see Gudriel flip. I think it's coming. I think we all know it now, and that was necessary because he is. I think he's going to join Castiel's purpose.
I think he's. I don't like the idea of. Well, I know you're not going to flip, but can you be my eyes and ears? You might as well flip then.
Yeah.
Like, if you're going to be listen, to me, if Gadriel or Gadriel, like, accepts that mission, he's more of a snake and
you
more
might
of a
as well,
chump.
Yeah.
I don't
because
want you
he's
to
acting
cheat.
As a spy.
I don't want you to cheat on your girlfriend. I just want you to sleep with me.
Let me just put it in a little bit, just for a couple seconds.
Just the tip of Dick Roman. And, and now the show is X-rated.
So stupid.
No, I mean, I think Gadriel has to flip because you can only fall for the same, oh, trust me, I'm a good guy so many times from Metatron, I think.
Yeah.
I would agree with that.
And when you see how much crap he's done to the Angels compared to Castiel.
I would agree with that up until what I just saw. My breakdown was I think Gadriel is trying to draw a line finally, and he already flipped sides once. And asked, he was with the Winchesters, and yes, he wasn't in it for size. He was in it to heal himself, and he wanted to hide in the vest. And Sam,
I'm going
to
hide in Sam,
creeping around in here
just for a little bit. Just
it's
for a little
warm
bit.
In here.
Just the tip.
okay, so he wasn't really on their side per se. He was kind of neutral. However, he picked his side, and I think how he's looking at it now by what he said was, "You want me to switch sides? You want me to switch sides?" You know, or flip again.
You think he'd rather go down with the wrong ship than be constantly jumping ship?
Right. Yeah. And that's what I think. I think he's trying to prove himself. I think he's accepted he's on the wrong side. I think he knows that Metatron is an evil son of a bitch who shouldn't be in control. I think he realizes that at this point. The minute he used him as a scapegoat to kill Angels and then, you know, basically give him up to the Winchesters like he did, make him his chump, I think Gadriel, it knows what he's in now. So
I just find that really, really, in my mind, I find that really stupid because anything that I do in my life, it's like, oh, if I'm wrong and I'm on the wrong side of something, I tend to switch.
Right.
So I just feel like that's almost too stubborn.
I think he's trying to save his reputation in any way he can.
Right.
I think
he's willing to go down with the ship in order to save his reputation that, hey, listen, at least he stood for something.
Exactly.
And I think that might be his mindset right now.
Going down with the ship almost.
Yeah.
He's like, I'd rather stand for something, even if it's wrong, and prove to the world who I am as a person, loyal, and I'm not the guy who screwed everything up.
Right. I'm an individual with an opinion.
Right. Rather than be right and have everyone still disrespect you and not trust you.
Right.
So I think that's where Gadriel's coming from.
Yeah. We pretty much just said the same thing about it. And it's sad because I think that's going to get him killed.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I think
sense of honor that he does indeed have, that we actually saw, the fact that he was willing to meet, like, the two generals they are, two generals met on the battlefield. He was willing to meet, you know, without bringing any people, because he could have killed Castiel if he wanted to. He could have brought, like, a legion of army and say, listen, I'm going to fool this guy.
He knows where he is.
Yeah, he didn't. And he respected the rules of war, whereas Metatron does not. And I think he's trying to the writers are trying to prop him up as the guy who yes, he killed Kevin, but he's an honorable man when it comes to the war at hand.
Here's the
thing. Accepts
honor.
Yeah.
Honor gets you killed.
All right, guys. So with that, final thoughts for the episode. Ryan?
You want me to go first?
I want you to go first.
Oh, geez. Wow. Yeah. That's the second time I've gone first tonight. this episode, man, I'm trying to think where I even want to go with this. It was definitely – I definitely like the inclusion of the new character.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we don't – you know, we'll see.
We'll see where that goes with that.
The I think they're going to revisit space, time, and continuum. I think that's, you know, with the whole jumping forward and going back in time.
That opens up a lot of possibilities.
The acting was great. The new, like I said, the new Theo or Gavin was good. I think it was really awesome to me when even Crowley was like, are you bargaining with me? Like,
I'm so proud.
Yeah. Like, that was cool. Obviously, we get more Crowley, Abaddon. Hosed, which you guys may not have. You thought it was early. I liked it.
Okay.
I think it needed to happen, especially if they're going to make this concentrate more on Metatron. She had to go.
You have to with two episodes.
She had to go. Dean in the First Blade is the coolest. One of the coolest things we've had in a long time. And again, his powers and him just being an ultimate badass when he gets that thing in his hand, dude. Like, it is so cool.
So overall grade.
The acting was a B plus. Episode B plus. I wasn't really oh my god factor.
Yeah.
Which would have gave it an A. I would say a solid B plus for it.
Mike, what about you?
Abaddon's death was regrettable, but it was a regrettable need. I felt like it was needed in the storyline at this point. I love what they're doing with the last two seasons, but closing out a storyline needs to happen. They needed it.
Yeah.
And it was sad to see Abaddon go, but we finally got to see Dean act out what he's been working towards since the mid-season opener. It opens up more questions about Dean. What's the point of the First Blade now? As I was saying, it served its purpose, but now he has no excuse any longer to wield the blade. How is it going to affect his relationship, et cetera? It's opened up a lot of additional questions. Like, what are we going to see now that his mission is done? The Gavin thing is just... I think is effing awesome. It's a slippery slope for sure, as we discussed, dealing with time travel.
Yeah.
However, it is a cool element. It is a very cool element, and it has possibilities, especially, I mean, anybody related to Crowley, I think, you know, the casting was right on, and I'm not just saying that because we have him for an interview. I thought he was a good choice. They recast the character. I don't think if they have possibilities open in the future for this guy to keep expanding his or growing his character, I don't think the other actor could have carried it as well as this guy. I think the guy they recasted the role with of Gavin MacLeod, I think is a better actor. And I think he can deliver a lot more. I think he has more range, as we saw. He played a goofy, like wiry, like fresh off the boat type kid.
Oh, he's very fresh faced.
Yeah, and now we're gonna see. And I think what we're gonna see with him, which is cool, is I think we're gonna see him change remarkably.
Do you think? And I know I'm cutting you off, but you think he might slowly turn into his dad?
Who knows? I mean, that's something
that's
you know, what if he comes to the opposite? Becomes actually the complete opposite of his dad because he doesn't like him. You know?
Makes sense as well.
So the only negative thing I thought is, and this goes in for the not just this episode, is I feel like we're losing Sam a bit since the entire Mark of Cain, I love Mark of Cain. Okay. However,
I think
it's overshadowed Sam so much that it seems like it's like he's not even there sometimes now. And it's a little disappointing. I would like them. I want to see more support from Sam. Sam needs to get the stick out of his ass when it comes to his brother. Because at this point, the way they wrote themselves this season is that's really his point. Is he needs to be there for his brother, And I think now that he's expressed his anger at him, he's expressed it, now they need to give him something else to do now at this point.
There needs to be something to pay off.
He needs to do something within those last two episodes. Yeah. Otherwise, I'll be a little disappointed because I understand him being kind of like ho-hum. It serves its point up to the Mark of Cain. Now we know you're upset at your brother, but the writers, I hope, have something in store for Sam for these next two episodes because he hasn't really shined that much anymore.
Yeah,
right. It has nothing to do with his acting. It has to do with just the writing is more focused on Mark.
As much to do,
right?
It's the plot.
Yeah.
Overall grade.
Writing for me was a B+. Acting was an A.
Okay. For me, I'm probably going to be the harshest on this episode.
Sounds about right.
Thank you, Ryan. I mean, I liked what they did with Gavin. I liked how he brings in a whole bunch of possibilities. My issue is with that is they did tell us to simmer down with the whole, you guys change the rules all the time with time travel, but I fear what they can do with that while also thinking it could be really cool. So I'm a little trepidatious on that, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
As far as Gavin, I think he'll
guys,
be
guys, by the way, trepidation means on the fence.
I think Gavin will be cool. I think they did well with casting him. I can't make a judgment call because he didn't have a lot to do. Although I did like how he brought up the fact that Crowley doesn't look like his dad did because he's possessed a different body.
Right.
And I was glad they paid attention to that.
Mm-hmm. Did they not do that in season 6 with the other one? When they brought back his ghost, right? Is that what it was?
His ghost, they
summoned him or something?
I think so. And he just kind of like knew it was him. As far as Dean, I think Dean did an awesome job. I loved what they did with that. I would have liked to see what exactly happened with that angel in the camp, but that may just be my own kind of fan fiction at this point. I liked that something did wrap up because, like Mike said, I think they did have to wrap up some storyline at this point. I just hate to see that it was Abaddon because I feel there was so much potential with that. And while I think it was cool that she was finally killed, I feel that the way they did it this early without a lot, like there was all this stuff talking about going on in the background, and then it just ended. And I feel like that was a missed opportunity for a lot more things. I'd like to see what they're doing with Crowley as he's going good or bad. You know, he could be our demon-sided Castiel, which would be really fun for me because I love Crowley.
Yeah.
And I felt that the scene with Abaddon versus Dean was a lot like season 3 with Sam versus Lilith. My powers don't work on you.
Yeah.
I'm afraid all of a sudden. And it ends badly for me.
I got that, too.
So I felt they kind of channeled that, which I would have liked to see something a little bit different with Crowley even taking her out to prove that he's the better player in
that
the chess game.
Cool.
I think that would have been really cool. So, again, that comes down to missed opportunities. As far as I agree, Mike, you brought up a really good point with Sam, is that I loved seeing his stuff because it used to be Sam was the emotional one that we can connect with in seasons 1 through 5, and Dean's the stoic, well, this is the job, this is what we do. So the few times he did show emotion, it hit all the harder, like season 2 where what should never be or whatever when he's in the dream world kind of thing. All those things mattered more, and I think that Sam hasn't been bad, but he just hasn't had enough to do. And that, like Ryan said, is a plot thing. The blade's completely overshadowed everything
else. He's fallen
into
the Chewbacca co-pilot scene.
Yeah.
He's just there, does a few gruff growls, and he hasn't really done much.
Yeah. And
which I'm fine with that for the most part. I'm okay with that with Han Solo. I'm okay with Jensen having his due because he needs to have something like this for him.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's been happening, but I didn't really notice it until this past episode. I'm like, I'm ready for some Sam now. Like, he's been quiet for a while now.
I mean, I expected a lot more from him once he found out that there was an angel in him and the betrayal and all that. And then it kind of just quieted down.
Just the tip was in him.
You want a little angel in you?
Where did the angel touch you?
Oh.
No, so I think that it's nothing bad on Jared Padalecki's part. I just think
not at
that
all.
This story has been 80% Dean, 20% Sam. I would have liked
At least since the mid-season.
Since the mid-season, you know. And we'll just have to see how that plays out. I think we're going to have to see something big from him at the finale. Yeah. For the episode, I give it a B, just because while it wasn't bad in any way, it was missed opportunities and things like I have a lot of questions about Sam and, you know, they kind of repeat
themselves.
Well,
isn't questions good, though?
It is good, yes, but when you have to look back on the entire season and none of it's been answered kind of thing,
right.
I think that's where little tidbits here and there like they did in seasons 4 and 5 would have been better.
He must have hated Lost.
I'm sure.
I never watched it because I thought that was the stupidest thing ever.
Oh, simmer down.
God, you are a lost show.
Can we make this guy troll of the week?
Yes.
If you can put up a sufficient argument, I'm okay with that. So, B from me.
Son of a bitch.
I was wondering when that was going to play out.
That was good.
Son of a bitch.
You going to have fun with that now?
All right. Well, we probably need to go to break. Yeah, Tom.
Yeah. So, with that, guys, we're going to take a break, and then we're going to get into the second to last episode, Stairway to Heaven. So, we will be right back.
Son of a bitch.
Hello, iTunes listeners. iTunes is a little bit harder to track for us, so please remember to always leave us a review. Most reviews on iTunes has to be done via iTunes. What you do is you search Supernatural the Crossroads on iTunes. You search Supernatural the Crossroads, leave us a review, and within 2 or 3 days, the review will pop up. Backstage casting. Backstage has thousands of roles available to search. Whether you're a leading lady or a background player, Backstage has got the role for you. To get started, you just create a profile, and your unique profile will be available to over 60,000 entertainment professionals looking for the next big thing. Backstage, the most trusted name in casting since 1960. To get started, just click the banner at the bottom of our webpage, supernaturalthecrossroads.com.
Fellas, are you looking to spice things up in the bedroom? Been fantasizing about surprising your lover with an adventurous new toy or adult movie? Well, here's an offer you won't be able to resist. Go to adamandeve.com, and for a limited time only, you'll get 50% off just about any item. But that's not all. Oh, no. When you select your one item at 50% off, you'll also receive 3 free adult DVDs for a little inspiration. Plus, a free extra gift so sensual, we can't mention it on the radio. And to top it all off, we'll even throw in free shipping on your entire order. And no, we're not teasing. So check out adamandeve.com today for this special offer. Get 50% off one item when you type DEAL30 for the offer code upon checkout. When you do, you'll get 3 free DVDs, a free extra gift, and free shipping. Just use offer code DEAL30. At adamandeve.com.
Hello?
Hello.
Hi.
Hey, you're on the radio right now.
Huh?
Yeah, you're on radio right now. Did you just wake up or?
No.
Oh, you sound kind of wait up. You sound like you just woke up.
No.
Oh.
But thank you.
Thank you? Why are you saying thank you for it?
I don't know, because it's just a weird thing to say, but No, I did not.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm trying not to be weird, but hey, so you again, you are on the Cast Radio Network, and here, I noticed I had a question for you really fast for you know, our listeners. I noticed here that you say, you know, it's $130 an hour for in-call, or in, what's that stand for? I see, I'm kind of slow when it comes
in. In-call, 200 out-call.
Okay, 200 out-call. Now, I'm really into my home, like, I don't like to be, like, things like, I'm really, like, a clean freak. Now, if I were to go to your house and save myself $70, is your house going to be clean? Because I noticed you live on 42nd and McDowell.
Very much so.
And that's kind of like a, you know, shitty area.
And it is very clean. I'm very clean.
Okay, because I was scared because, like, about, I think 2 or 3 months ago, my fiance was murdered and raped out there in that side of town. So that's
really?
Why I'm kind of...
I'm right on the corner of, like, 44th.
Now, is that you on this listing here?
Yes, those are my pictures.
Okay, okay, great. Because I've always had a thing for...
And I look just like myself.
Because I've always had a thing for Justin Bieber, and you kind of look like an aged Justin Bieber a little bit. Like, if Justin Bieber was a woman...
Look like what?
Like if he was a woman and he was like 40 years old, that would be perfect.
If I was a woman,
you're
30.
You're 38, right? You're 38.
Well, actually, I'm 39 now.
The Rain Man Show, coming soon to Rain Man Digital.
Yeah. Definitely.
Doors are all closed. With a word, she can get.
So our next episode, Stairway to Heaven, with very apt music from Michael. Thank you. So after a massive attack on the Angels, Castiel calls Sam and Dean for help. As they leave, Dean's eagerness to bring the first blade doesn't go unnoticed by Sam, who is worried about the cost to his brother whenever he uses the blade. Meanwhile, Castiel is shocked when he learns the angel that caused the attack was one of his followers and did it in his name. Dean discovers there is a conspiracy among Castiel's angel followers, and at the heart of it is Tessa, the Reaper.
And insert new character from past.
Yeah. Was that season 2?
Well, they brought her back.
Yeah.
Season 2 is when she was introduced.
When she was first introduced.
And then
she was
in the same episode with the King of Death. With also, Death
when they were bringing back Sam's soul.
Yeah.
Also,
I believe she was in there.
Also, spoiler alert, angel followers are... basically, there is a bad person in
there. Yeah, goddamn it, man.
Yeah, you suck.
Again, I think that was my idea was better, but okay.
So, hubris,
I know, but.
From what it sounds like to me, we're going to get some angel on angel violence here.
Angel on angel action?
As long as they're hot, I don't care. boy. No, I think we're going to. Here's the thing. Obviously, this episode is going to be. Another character that's from the past,
right,
coming back into the fold here. So that's a kind of a theme with this season.
Yeah, well,
it has felt like that.
They do that though a lot. They'll bring back people.
No, they do.
Here and
I just feel like this season has been very heavy with that.
Yeah,
and I think.
Yeah, oh yeah.
I wonder if that's a lot of that has to do with not knowing that they were going to get another season. Saying, hey, let's bring these characters back and maybe close them off.
Mm-hmm. I think some of that is like, let's close it off in case we have to end it here. I think also some of that was. How well receptive new characters were through season 7 and 8,
mm-hmm.
the first half
right,
of 8.
Right.
It wasn't too hot with Benny and the entire Leviathan gang.
Yeah. I'm just happy that we're going to get to see more Sam and Dean fighting over the first blade. Let's be honest. When Dean struggles with the first blade, it is like the coolest thing ever. Like, it's just, like you said, he's teetering on that dark side kind of.
He's on the brink.
He's on the brink, and I like that. I do. I agree with you a lot that is an awesome aspect of. Yeah.
I'm hoping to see, because it says Dean's eagerness to bring the first blade doesn't go unnoticed by Sam. So I'm hoping Sam doesn't just shrug it off. I want there to be a discussion, or Sam. I want, people who, Sam needs to quit bitching. Listen,
he hasn't bitched, okay?
I want to see him bitch now. I want to see him get a little more aggressive and be like, listen, dude, enough with this first blade. You're going to karate, you're going to kill me, okay?
You're going to knock down.
Were you going to say karate chop?
Yeah, like, you're going to karate chop my head off.
You're going to kung fu grip me.
Yeah, so I'm hoping because of that, I hope we're going to get a little more Sam, a little more something for Sam to do as well.
Yeah, I think it's time. Honestly,
yeah,
we said that a little bit ago.
Well, I saw a preview where Castiel was holding back Dean.
Yeah,
I did see the preview for like a part of it. I try not to watch previews, but I did see where Castiel was holding back Dean and something.
Hold me back, bro.
For about a second. It's like about one or two seconds in the preview. Hmm. So who knows, dude? Maybe Castiel is going to start interfering.
Stop spoiling yourself, dude. So,
I don't know.
I think he has to as well. I mean, it is the end of the season, so a lot of moving parts have to finally come together. But I think Castiel and Sam are going to realize, with how eager, like they say, that Dean is, and especially with Abaddon dead, they're like, you can put that down, put the knife away. So when he's just like, kill crazy, then they're going to have to.
Do we even know if the first blade works against Metatron?
Well,
would it?
Here's
it's a demon
thing.
Weapon.
Do we, again, that's actually the point I was going with. Yeah. It's like, yes, Sam wants him to put the blade away. But we really don't know what the blade does. And I think...
It's a mystery. Which the cult wasn't. Which that's why I like this weapon a lot in a different way. Like, some people say, well, they already used a weapon like this before. They used the cult. The cult, we can do what it did. It killed demons.
Well, here, that's
it
the thing.
It killed supernatural
beings.
It killed supernatural beings. This, there's a mystery to it.
I think a little bit... I think it's 75% Dean wants the blade, to use the blade because he lusts for it.
Right.
And I think another 25% of that is... he doesn't know what it can do, and he wants to use it on anything he possibly can get his hands on because
he can solve all his problems.
He can solve all his
He's
problems.
He's like a 12-year-old boy who just discovered his penis. That's really what it is.
That's so true.
It's a whole new world out there for him.
Yeah.
It really is, dude. It's opened the doorway for
Take that out of your hands. Put it down. No, it's mine.
If Sam wants to hold the burden for him.
Oh.
Let me hold this burden for you,
no.
Mr. Frodo.
Oh, Jesus.
I can hold the burden.
You are the worst hobbit.
Oh, my God. I think the first blade, it does have the possibility to do a lot more. We don't really know.
Well, it's the mystery behind it, which
exactly.
This is what I like.
But at the same time, I think it's been said, well, maybe not entirely, but that, like, angels are stronger than demons. That's been established.
Yeah.
Like
they run. Like, oh. They run from angels.
Exactly. It's not really a contest. And the angels are killed more often by their own angels with the that little short blade mm-hmm. they have, like, mm-hmm. you know, Roman centurion or whatever.
Yeah.
So will the first blade equal that? I don't know. I mean, it is Cain's, so it can kill a knight of hell, which has been previously immortal to stuff. And does the first blade outweigh an angel knife? Because if it is the only thing that can kill a knight, then that means it's better than the angel blade.
Yeah.
If, right.
Or
yeah.
they never thought to ask Castiel to borrow that.
Yeah.
So hey. One of the two, like, you know.
Hey, like, Cass, can we borrow your
sword? Yeah. You got the Mark of Cain and the first blade. I could have given you this.
Yeah.
All you had to do is ask. Like, that tells us that it's got some
special powers
to it.
I think it's going
to
slaughter angels.
Well, okay, in these next two episodes, guys, like I said, things got to start closing up. Now,
yes.
Then why bring in
Tessa? They did announce that Castiel is coming back for season 10. So we know he's not going to die. We know that he's – but however, they need to close – in my personal opinion, and I think the writers know this, they need to close out the angel battles. This has been going on now for a while now.
5 seasons?
Yes. I think that the angel problem may be fixed. The heaven issue may be fixed, okay? I don't know how they're going to bring him back. I'm just speculating here.
Yeah.
But I honestly think they're setting up Dean to be the bad guy next season.
I got that feeling too. I didn't want to say this because I'm like, oh, that'd be so shitty. But in season 8, when him and Sam are fighting, trying to find the Hellhound, the first trial, he says, you know, he's going to die with a gun in his hand going down swinging. Mm-hmm. I'm like, what if Sam's the one who has to be the one who puts him down,
right?
Because he's always going to fight as long as Sam's in danger, and with the first blade he thinks he can end all the problems, you know, because
right.
they couldn't close the gates before. Maybe that's where they take it. That'd be really dark. And then eventually
awesome.
You have that whole thematic brother versus brother Michael Lucifer
again,
thing,
which is their destiny,
full circle, which is yeah exactly
well
is
we've,
their destiny.
We've seen that the parallels between this
exactly.
season, we've seen it coming back full circle again, going from Michael and Lucifer
Cain
and now
and
we
Abel.
See Cain and Abel
yeah.
which I think is genius. And I honestly, if the writers are smart and they want to really push the envelope, it's a slippery slope.
Yeah,
with the audience, because the writers might say, "Let's make Dean the bad guy," but there may be people like,
"No, risky.
No, it is. It's extremely risky,
risky
dude." But that is what writing
about.
No,
it would pay off so well.
It's
dude.
Not that risky because they made Sam the bad guy at one point.
He wasn't
sort
a true
of.
Bad guy though. It was
but,
Lucifer that was the bad guy.
But he was
and
still,
Sam was possessed.
Yeah, but
it
he was
different.
They still made him the bad guy.
But the good thing
it's
with that
different
was,
though, because Dean would be on his own.
Yeah,
yes,
there's no outside influence.
He willingly took the mark of Cain. He accepted it. He knew there'd be consequences.
But it's not
and
Dean when he touches the blade.
In. Dude, yes, it is. It's just him giving in. Dude, Dean's always struggled with dark, dude. We've never. Sam was the one doing bad things. He's drinking the demon blood. Yada yada yada.
I think it's
you
the
know.
Blade, man. I think it's the blade taking over.
I don't know.
What was it when he was in hell and he enjoyed interrogating people?
He was in hell for 60 years. You got to enjoy something.
And you
in
don't
hell,
think
don't
that, and you don't think that left something inside of him, something dark.
Well, I mean,
dude, he's been in purgatory and in hell. You don't think there's some type of influence on him?
I
think a little bit, but
what Mike's saying, because Dean has always, like you said, has always struggled with the dark. Sam was always the one who was trying to do good, and it would ultimately end up hurting people.
I don't think Dean's a bad guy.
No.
I don't think Dean thinks it through sometimes.
Well,
and
Lucifer didn't think he was a bad guy.
Right.
You know, it's perspective. And in the, you know, Bible, Michael is a soldier who just does what he's told. You know, that was kind of always what he did. The duty is what matters. And in a way, you can think of that as a kind of evil as well, when the angels were going to just nuke a city because it was easier.
Right.
You know, morality comes into play there. And Sam has always tried to do the right thing and ended up with hurting people.
Yeah.
And Dean has always like been like end game more than anything else. So I think Dean could go down that route. Now, is it risky because of the fandom? And I would hate to see that as well. Yes. But at the same time, from like a writing storyline standpoint, that would be awesome.
It would
pay off
shock.
So well, you'd have that Breaking Bad. How far do you go when you're trying
right.
to do the right thing?
It
right.
would
quotes,
shock the fans.
You know?
Right.
Where do you draw that line yeah. then?
And again, going with what Ryan says, I agree. I don't think Dean's a bad guy. And I do
no.
think I think the blade is pushing him. Yes, for sure.
Yes.
I think it's the Lord of the Rings thing. That's why
it's
you
totally,
know Crowley
yeah.
made a joke about the precious. That's the whole point. Just like Frodo put on the ring and it made him dark. It made him
yeah.
sick. It made him very selfish. It made him want it and need it no matter what. That is what this is doing. I think Dean is being influenced and he's being contaminated. By this diseased weapon, in a sense,
and that's.
But I think that there is a part of him that also enjoys it.
I think that's the thing too. Is like Sam made the choice to have Lucifer come into him. With jokes aside, yes, we
I
know
mean,
it's
do
an
you
easy
do
one.
You remember Sam when he killed the vampire in season 2? He beheaded him. He said he
yeah.
enjoyed it. He had, when he was with, remember the black dude, Hunter, that was kind of off his rocker?
Yeah, yeah.
Remember he said he enjoyed cutting that? I liked it.
Yeah.
So Dean's always been a little bit in the enjoyment of killing monsters.
Yeah, because he thinks it's the right thing to right. do, you know. And Sam let Lucifer in for the right reason. I can take him back to hell. I can end it. And ultimately, through his brother, he overcomes Lucifer and, you know, opens the portal and all that stuff.
Yeah.
That was a decision for the betterment of everybody else. And I think with the blade, Dean's making decisions for the betterment of himself right now. He's lost sight of
right.
help I, Sam.
It ended,
let's do what works for me.
It started off as something positive.
And, it's
and because he's gotten
dark.
Sickened by it, I think he's being sick. These are the after effects now.
Yeah.
So it's going to be awesome regardless. I think we're, yes. these next two episodes are going to be.
You know it's going to be a cliffhanger, dude.
Oh, for
sure. Oh, without a doubt.
Dude, it's got to end with Blade and Sam's back and Dean just standing
no.
over him. What if it ended that way,
oh,
dude?
My God, dude.
Dude.
I would not be dude, happy.
It would be so sad, dude. But, like, not that Sam's going to die, but, I mean, what if it ended like that? All right, we need to go to break, I think.
All right. So, yeah, we're going to take a break, and then we've got a couple little bit of news things as well as Troll of the Week. So we'll be right back.
They're choosing him over me.
You're the one who asked him to lead an army.
But what you've got here is a cult.
I do this for Castiel.
Castiel came to me.
For Castiel!
I'm gonna be sick.
Fun's just getting started.
Supernatural, all new. Tuesday at 9, 8 central on the CW.
Hello there, Supernatural fans. This is show producer Michael Flores. Just a reminder to please leave us reviews on Stitcher. Head over to Stitcher.com and search Supernatural The Crossroads. Leave us a review. Every review left helps us get seen by more eyes. More eyes, more listeners. And the show keeps growing. Thank you for listening to the show.
Back with a list we found on the internet with top 10 spinoffs we'd like to see now that Bloodlines has been canceled.
Right.
So, which
is a positive. If you listen,
if we get something better,
I don't want to be a troll, but listen, you know what? No one seemed to have enjoyed it, and I think this is the you know, we're getting the best. You know what? At least they're canceled it, and they're saying, listen, there's a possibility of another one, a strong possibility.
Yeah, right. I mean,
that's a plus.
If you can get something better than
yes.
Bloodlines. Out of it, ultimately, that's probably
yeah.
for the best.
Well, what they did was they put out a feeler with this backdoor pilot.
Exactly. That's exactly
and
what
they said, okay, this one sucks. Let's try another one.
Simmer down with the suck, though, but yeah.
It's
no, I'm back and running on this.
Just like my Twitter post, you know, it, hashtag sorry I'm not sorry.
Yeah, I liked that one.
Dude, this article actually had some pretty good ideas. Some of them I agree with, Thomas yeah. and Ryan. Some of them I don't,
yeah.
but we can go through these pretty fast.
Okay.
These are, and then we have, Thomas, we also have the, there was also the discussion of, this goes hand in hand with the discussion slash question of the week.
We asked people which spinoff
right,
they
so
would
we'll,
like to
we'll
see.
Read those afterwards.
Yeah. So one of them is Charlie and Dorothy in Oz.
No.
I mean that sounds cool, but I don't
no.
think there's enough there.
If it was reworked and it wasn't so goofy themed and they focus on the dark elements, I think it would be a cool idea.
Yeah. If
I don't know.
Dark Oz,
I don't know
yes.
if they can carry an entire
dark
spin-off.
Dark Oz would be cool.
Dark Oz would
yeah.
be cool.
I mean, look how dark the witch as, was. Remember the evil
yeah,
witch? She's
yeah.
pretty evil. I think the thing that made it goofy is that, you know, yes, we love Felicia Day, but, you know, when she enters this episode, you know it's going to be kind of a like
silly
a,
one.
Dude, a silly
as long
one.
As yeah. as long as both of them are very scantily clad, I would watch it very
yeah.
much.
All right.
Okay.
The next one, Sweet Life of Jody Mills, having her storyline and what she's been doing. Again, I mean, we just touched on that.
Yeah.
I feel like that's possible, but
I think she could do it with other cast members.
She would need
well.
Yes.
someone else.
Yeah, yeah.
Like just
and give her a strong story and
make it
her,
a sitcom.
Yeah. However, I think we need to stay away from, you know, my quick input is we need to stay away from Hunter spinoffs. Why are we doing Hunter spinoffs? You know,
right.
the
that's
article,
what we
the,
essentially
the,
are watching
the,
now.
The CW is, press statement originally with Bloodlines was they wanted to stay away from
to do the same thing.
Their goal was not to do like CSI Miami.
Yeah.
They didn't want yet another Hunter show. But then that's what they did was give you something that was mm-hmm. predominantly about a Hunter again with a little bit of monsters in
against
the background.
Families
I
and
think
monsters.
The spinoff needs to just stay away from Hunter. Have Hunters yeah. in the world, but like why are we focused on? There's so many epic elements you can focus on.
It's like I said, it needs to be very character driven. driven. Yeah. Because the world has been explored and established.
You have to have good characters.
You have to care about it, like Breaking Bad, Walking Dead, stuff like that. Zombies have been done to death, but the characters are what makes
you
Walking
have
Dead
to care
good.
About like Sam and Dean.
Exactly.
It has to be like that.
So then we got another one, Adventures of Kevin and Linda Tran.
No.
I think we can just go over that.
That's
one.
A bad idea.
That's just a no.
You've been Garthed, having something with Garth and the werewolf family.
I would actually watch that. That one, because I like Garth because he's a funny character.
Well, that's just the thing, though. I'll let you go ahead, finish. Sorry.
I don't think that wouldn't be a very much of a serious.
Yeah. It'd be a supernatural sitcom.
It'd have to be a
30-minute special.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. Like, while he is funny and he's good for those breaks in the drama, essentially. I think that would run thin really quick.
It wouldn't hold a series.
It would be a mistake. It would be it's like Joni and Chachi. You know, you had Happy Days, but then you had Joni and Chachi.
Joni loves Chachi. Yeah.
So, again, kind of a meh on that one for us, at least.
Right.
A story about Bobby and Rufus with It Happened in Omaha, that like thing that...
Yeah, I would do...
Yes, right away.
Yes.
Bobby and Rufus.
Well, this is pretty much... This is almost what you were saying.
Yeah, dude.
But, yes, I would love to see... See, the problem with that is that sounds like a 3-episode, like, oh, here's what happened in Omaha. Okay, now we're done.
Yeah.
Like, that would be like a like 3-episode, like...
To me, personally, that it happened in Omaha, the Bobby and Rufus story, that sounds like the love story of Brokeback Mountain Supernatural version. I mean,
God.
Come on.
No, I agree with Ryan, though. I think that would be like a better miniseries or something.
Miniseries would be cool.
Rather than a show on its own. Then we've got... This one I like a lot. Wild Wild West, The Life and Times of Samuel Colt.
Yes. We have talked about that.
Mike brought that up.
You brought that up.
There was a rumor years ago that there was going to be a Western-themed spinoff. This was back when Kripke was still running the show. I would be down for this.
Dude, I would watch that in a heartbeat.
I mean, dude, it's dark. I mean, isn't he the one who built the Devil's Gate? Like, that was locked in.
He built that whole, like, train station.
Yeah, I mean, dude, there's so...
The cult itself.
You could do 2 seasons on why he built that.
Yeah. Easy.
Yeah.
I just want to see him putting the cult together. That would be awesome.
That would be fun to have one of the first hunters in history that we know of kind of thing. Then you have Portrait of a Young Hunter, Mary Campbell, their mom and her life. Again, I don't...
You bring back Skinner. You bring back Skinner. You bring him back, dude, and make it a family affair. It could be interesting.
It could work because here's the reason. You bring back their mom and... Or the girl that played the young version.
Their young
then
mom.
I'm not saying that, but you've got a hot girl.
Strong female lead, possibly.
A strong female lead who's attractive.
Like Jodie Mills. So.
But she has her own show now.
Yeah.
So
that could be good. I could see the potential with it, but again, like the Campbells completely burned me for season 6. I don't trust any of them ever.
No, not
so I don't
bit.
Necessarily know if I'd want to watch them win.
Hard pass.
Yeah. So
talk about it.
Exactly. This one's probably my favorite. John Winchester's Journal.
Yes.
That would be cool to see a story of like seasons of where he's going, he's learning to get
through. Yes, what I would love to see is episodes, and each episode is literally an entry in his journal.
That's kind of what they did for the first season, though.
But at the same time, I want to see him pin that in the journal after he's done messing. Like, every episode is a journal entry.
So you want to cross between Sex and the City and Vampire Diaries?
Oh, wow.
I think it could be really cool with because he was.
How about a Doogie Howser version? Today I learned at the end of each episode. Today I learned that you kill a demon with salt and holy water.
I
learned
really
a lot.
Cool.
I grew as a man this episode. Plus,
so
I got
stupid.
Laid.
I think it would be really cool. I think it has a lot of potential. You have the fallout of Mary's death, which he wasn't a hunter at that point. You have him trying to learn everything on his own while being a father.
I'm sorry, Ryan. I pissed all over your idea.
Pissed all over my idea that the one show that I would watch in a heartbeat, and you had to piss all over it.
Yeah.
What a dickhead.
Well, I don't know, dude. I think him learning how to do all that stuff on his own, essentially, while being a dad,
dude,
would be a big thing.
That journal is so thick. There's side notes, pages that slipped out.
Yeah.
Who knows what's in that journal?
You have all that material then, too. But also I think the fact of him reconciling with her death while trying to be a dad and a hunter, and the fact that he met that other woman who had their half-brother.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, see, there's another storyline.
Again, if you go very character-driven, emotional, that could be really good.
I need to get... See, Ryan's been dead this whole show. He's had no energy, and I know the only thing that gets Ryan... I know the only thing that gets Ryan is some jokes and some, like, perverted, like, comments. then now he's in the game.
I am crying over here. Oh, my God. Jesus.
All right.
I agree with you, Thomas.
Yeah.
I mean, fuck Mike. But I think this that show right there, I would tune in every week in a heartbeat. And I want to see them bring the prop back from the original, you know, diary,
mm-hmm.
and have them literally and you know, like
fill
some
it in.
Of, yeah, fill it in. And some of the episodes where we actually get to see some of the pages.
Yeah.
And you know, and maybe like an episode where it's like, oh, what's this side thing? Actually have him go in and pin that stuff.
That would be cool.
Would be cool. It would be really neat.
That would be sweet. Next one we have Metal Letters, Henry Winchester's story.
Same
I don't know.
Thing. Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of, again, like the Hunter idea, but from like a more intelligent standpoint.
I wouldn't mind getting more Men of Letters, though.
Yes. Now,
could be cool.
Henry Winchester, no, even though I like his character. But Men of Letters, yes. I mean, there is so much that has nothing. Like, I remember I read an article that with Bloodlines, they wanted to keep demons and angels out of it.
Right.
But because they didn't, that was supernatural. That's supernatural. Right. Bloodlines is monsters. But I don't think you need to draw lines like that because there's so many stories that you can tell with demons involved or satanic type creatures.
Yeah.
And Men of Letters is neck deep in it. I mean, they're magic and sorcery and all types of cool things and unlimited. Talk about
there's unlimited.
You brought up the journal. I mean, talk about unlimited possibilities.
Oh. I mean, if you have Oz as a dimension you can travel into.
Well, look, yeah,
I mean,
different universes, time travel. You have no idea. I mean,
they have the bunker built already.
Yeah.
You could use it right there as the set and just have and introduce us to new Men of Letters.
I mean, and think about
it.
It'd
be cool.
They could actually do a Highlander type deal.
There can only be one.
So stupid. They can do like a Highlander type thing, dude, with this. Like, meaning because they, you know, Men of Letters have been around forever.
Yeah.
I mean, they can do stories in the past, the present. They have so many possibilities.
I mean,
like,
there's tons of possibility there. I wasn't entirely sure if, like, the Men of Letters would be enough of characters to
to me, it's one of the few spinoffs that would live up to the epicness of what Supernatural
is.
The lore alone.
And that's what I'm looking at. Okay, you can't go back. You can't do Star Trek the Motion Picture after you did the Wrath of Khan. And that's what they did with Bloodline. They went back and did Star Trek the Motion Picture, which sucked.
Yeah.
Once you do Star Trek II, the Wrath of Khan, you can't go back to the V'ger. Okay, and that and that with this, with the Men of Letters, I think you would be on par. You have the epic world right there.
With that show, they could increase the universe of Supernatural because they could introduce things that, you know, that the regular show hasn't introduced yet.
Yeah, dude.
And you could go in depth, and you're just creating more of a universe there.
It has a lot of potential, so that could be another
plus,
good one.
Plus, if they did it with, I am immortal, I have inside me blood of kings.
So the last one here, this one, Ryan, I know will like, The Father of Murder, The Story of Cain.
Dear God. Okay, I'm in.
I think that just, we've said this enough. They just need to make that.
That would be on par with epicness.
I would have to change my underwear now.
I would be very okay with this. Old West Kane, too. I mean, I'd love to see that. I don't even care if we go back to medieval times. It doesn't matter.
But that's the thing with that show, because he is pretty, you know, back
to... You could do a Highlander storyline with this guy.
You could literally do a Highlander storyline with this guy and hit. And that's a really... You can create a lot of cool set pieces with, you know, like you said, Roman times or Western. You could hit every era... And have every era of clothing or you know, piece that with him, and that character could hold a show on his own. He's so badass.
Yeah, and so Mike posed this question to Facebook, and most of the responses we actually got was something involving the Men of Letters. Again, like too much lore to pass up. Essentially, a show of Men of Letters. They knew a lot of things that we've never seen before.
Are you talking about on Facebook?
Yeah.
Okay, so we've moved to say the name of the person, and then
Christina SPN.
All right.
And she says, a show of Men of Letters. They knew a lot of things that we've never seen before. It would be very interesting. And we just said that exact sentence, essentially.
Did you read Michelle Smith, too? Did you read that one? Did you not
Yeah,
see
I did.
Okay.
Michelle Smith, I was looking down.
Oh, okay. You can't
I was looking
read.
Down. I had to go back up.
The caption's on the left side, remember? Not underneath the picture.
Michelle Smith says, some sort of prequel. The boys hunting with John when he first started. Maybe go deeper into the world of angels and demons. There are so many great possibilities if the writing and cast is there. Mm-hmm. Again, we think John could be really cool as well.
Let me ask this question because you guys are writers. Do you get really weird if they did do something like that and they didn't recast the people that were in the show before? Like,
you mean have the original actors again?
Like the original, like young Sam and Dean come back to play young
Sam.
I'm okay
with that. I mean, if they have to recast younger versions.
Yeah. The recasting is not as much of an issue as it is making sure all the parts fall into place.
Personally, I think they need to stay away. Honestly, this is my own opinion. Yeah. There are a lot of people that want to see Winchester stuff. I think we need to stay with the spinoff, stay away from Winchester stuff.
I think so, too.
Because what they're going to end up doing is messing up, you know, possibilities. Yes. For the original Supernatural and Supernatural movies that I want.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, I mean,
so just leave the Winchester. Let the Winchester storyline be the Winchester storyline.
From a writing standpoint, prequel, you have so many more opportunities to screw something up.
Yeah.
Because this had to happen beforehand. Star Wars. Yeah. Star Wars. You know, you miss one thing that was supposed to happen.
Yeah, but we got Darth Maul, guys.
20 years later. Darth Maul was cool, but that's like 10 minutes out of an entire movie.
Wow, what a dick.
Who else do we have?
Anna Kelly said they had officially been disgusting. Disgusting?
Are you just skipping them?
I'm jumping around. A lot of them are the same.
Okay.
discussing a Western following Samuel Colt, but it was scrapped. I'd love to see it, though. A show about Henry and Josie would be good, and considering we know their ending would prevent the CW from making a stupid drama twist where Henry cheats on his wife, an Elliot Ness series would also be great.
Ooh, Elliot Ness.
The Untouchables, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that could be cool, too.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah,
I'm good at that.
It's still a Hunter thing.
Do you have
any
more over there?
Barbara, pardon me, but Raby? R-I-E-B-E.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to see a John Winchester prequel. Too much recasting. Having to cast yet another set of young actors for the boys. Potential nightmare. Now, Men of Letters, they could do a different story every season.
Yeah.
Also true. You could go the American Anthology Horror Story route. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of stuff's doing that now. So.
All right, going over to Google Plus now. We have, let's see. We have Shavindra Banaraki. Sorry if I really screwed that up. Men of Letters spinoff. About the creation of everything and Lucifer rebelling and stuff. Okay.
Ooh.
So a lot of people are wanting Men of Letters. The Dark Lord, Cain or Gabriel, Angel Wars is all he wrote. Dude, he's pitching it like Hollywood style. Cain, Gabriel.
Exactly. Elevator pitch.
Angel Wars. Yeah. Picture. Balthazar. And Gabriel.
I thought you said Battlestar Galactica. I was like, yes.
Balthazar and
Gabriel. Now, that would be comedy gold. That was from Melanie Hampson. Fatima Dupree, I would love to see Bobby and Rufus in their own early years.
Yeah.
It could lead up to when they had their falling out and have guest appearances from other hunters like John or Ellen.
Also good.
Yeah, I could see that. I mean, that's not bad. Let's see here. Let's see, we have Holly Weasel, definitely Balthazar, and Gabriel. They would be amazing with added Crowley because he's brilliant. Letitia Hobart, Bobby and Rufus, Charmaine Asmine, Cain. So she's just saying she wants a Cain's one. Joseph Bartolio. How about the teenagers from season 8 or maybe Ghostfacers? What teenagers from season 8?
The teenage group that one dude killed all their parents to make them better hunters.
Oh, that was kind of done like that one J.J. Abrams show.
Yes.
It was the one person camera shot. Is that what you're talking about?
No, not that one. The one where, remember that girl that befriends Dean and she calls him an old man? And her dad was a hunter,
okay.
And then all their parents got murdered, and they went off like on a vendetta.
That's right.
And they had their
that dude killed their entire family, the older guy.
Yeah, the older guy.
All right. G. Lauren says Men of Letters or a Castiel spinoff. I can get behind a Castiel spinoff.
I could do a Cast spinoff.
I think if they go Castiel, they'd have to go way back. I'd like to see like old world his interaction with some of these famous biblical things we've heard of.
Well, he's another Highlander character.
How about a Gadriel spinoff where he just sits in a cell every episode?
Like the most boring Truman Show ever.
He just masturbates the entire time. I'm so effing bored. I'm just going to play with my dick.
He's got calluses.
Oh my God. Stupid Ryan.
My God.
Okay, Bobby Singer with the boys, father, all the major players they killed off. So I guess people they've killed off, you know, people. I think that's messing with it.
Yeah.
I like it, but it's messing with
a lot of.
Yeah, it's scary.
There's a lot of continuity. You have to really work continuity, whatever.
Let's see. Something with Ruby, someone said.
Yes.
Mariam.
You know, Ruby never was that interesting to me.
Give me more Ruby.
She was hot, both versions, but I think she
first version was better, but she's on Arrow now.
Someone's getting all Star Wars with this. One person says, Darlene 3D said, Supernatural Invincible, set in the future about Dean's son or daughter, because odds are he has a load of them.
That person just wins comment. That is comment of the week. That wins right there.
Oh let's see. And I think the rest of them.
What, how about this? What about this? And I know you would have to obviously get Dean, but what about the whole spinoff where the virus. The virus.
Oh, like the zombie? The Croatoa?
How cool would that be? Like a straight up.
That'd be pretty cool. Like I mean, I love how they brought that back in.
Post-apocalyptic.
Look at this idea. One per.
I got one real quick. Remember how they had that spin-off alternate timeline where Sam becomes the devil and everything goes to hell?
Oh, post-apocalyptic world.
Do that. Alternate.
I just said that.
Oh, did you?
Jesus Christ. Oh, I thought you were...
Sorry, bro.
You totally pulled a Ryan right there. So what are the thoughts on this episode?
Dude.
Oh, my God.
No, I thought you were saying something with just the virus. I didn't think you meant that entire universe.
I was thinking that whole universe.
Okay.
Oh, man, I'm in tears.
Apologize.
No, that's gold. That is gold right there.
Okay, we got one from Betty Everett. Cass, definitely. Crowley, possible. I vote for resurrection of Bobby's spirit to enter a younger body and get back with the boys. So they want the essence of Bobby, basically. Yeah. Which, you know what? Dude, I don't know. It might be interesting. What if Bobby's spirit went into a woman's body? That'd be kind of funny.
That'd be really funny.
It would be for a good one episode thing.
It would be good for a
not
one
a
episode
spin-off.
Thing. But again, like, you know, you need to let
some
characters
sit. Supernatural, Bobby Singer as a woman. It'd be a great spinoff.
You guys are idiots.
He just looks at his boobs all the time in the mirror.
You guys are idiots. I got boobs.
Oh my god.
Okay.
So I think that's it for the spinoffs.
This is out of hand, dude. Yeah. We don't have time for Troll of the Week.
We'll have to save that one.
Yeah, we've pushed it.
We've gone way over. All right, so with that, just stay right where you are. We're going to have the interview coming up in just a moment, and hopefully it's as good as Kim Rhodes.
Yes.
Don't go nowhere. Supernatural, The Crossroads will be right back.
Guys, and we're back with an interview now we have with Theo, I'm going to say this wrong again, Devaney. Okay, I'm remembering the way you told me how to remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll say that.
How did I tell you?
You want me to say that part? I think we'll keep that a secret.
Yeah,
that a secret.
It's nothing about Theo. It's just, I come up with the most oddest things to help me remember names.
Well, thankfully, Theo is on the line. Ryan had to step out. but Maggie has stepped in for us, and we want to thank her for that.
Yes, hello, Maggie. Thank you for having me. It was fun.
Whoa, are you offended by the C word?
No, cunt.
Oh.
I had to.
All right, so with that, we're going to check out this interview.
All right, let me get him on. All right, so we have on the line, we have the one and only Theo Devaney. Now, I said that correct, right? Your last name, Theo?
Yes, you did.
Okay. Well, we've been debating it since we went after you for the interview, and we're like, is it Devaney? Is it Devaney? Like, are you
uppity?
Are you getting uppity with it? Are you like what?
No, Devaney would be a little bit posher, really, than the real provenance of the name. It's an Irish name.
Oh, is it?
Okay.
It goes back to like a Roman. Yeah, I think it's like a Roman name they left behind in Ireland. Yeah, it's from my mum's side. My mum's maiden name, actually.
Okay, so are you Irish then? Are you British or are you Scottish? Like, I'm so confused.
I'm a bit of a mongrel, really. I mean, in terms of my personality, I'm probably British, probably English British, but my blood is Irish, Scottish, English, and Italian.
Okay.
So I'm a bit of a mix, yeah.
So do you ever wage war with yourself?
I'm in constant conflict with myself. But I try to keep, you know, people around me protected from that, you know?
Because I make the same jokes about myself because I'm Mexican Irish, and I'm like, I'm the worst kind of drunk. I'm Mexican Irish.
What do you choose? What do you go for, though? Whiskey or the tequila?
Oh, yeah, I go for the tequila.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Understandable.
I like to get the quick buzz, and that's pass. I like to be passed out, blackout, not remember who I am.
Oh, the next day.
Yeah, it saves you having to go over any, having to deal with your conscience, doesn't it? You don't need a conscience when you just don't remember anything.
Exactly. But now, how did you get involved with Supernatural, Theo? Like, do you live in where they shoot? Or do you live in Canada, or are you in L.A.? Are you based in L.A.?
No, I live in Vancouver, actually.
Okay.
I lived in London as an actor for a long time and did a lot of theatre. Most of my work was theatre and some TV and some indie film. I did a lot of radio, some video games. I just did a lot of different sort of technical acting stuff, but most of my artistic, I suppose, acting was theatre. And then a few friends of mine are actors in Vancouver, a couple of them Canadians, and they said, why not come out here and have a look at some film and TV work? And, the industry in England is, it's wonderful in terms of what it creates.
Yeah.
Quality of content is really high, but we don't have the kind of commercial industry that North America has because we don't have the marketplace.
Yeah.
So we tend to export a lot of period work and stuff, which I think Britain does brilliantly well. But we don't have the resources. Many of the production companies don't have the resources, the funding, to make kind of these fantastic sci-fi epics and these kinds of really ambitious technical shows like Supernatural. So I had dreams of, running through the forest dressed up as an elf, having fights with people. And in some ways I fulfilled my objective, which was to come and be in sort of some fantastic production, surrounded by wonderful actors, lots of effects and stuff.
So did you make the move then first, or did you get the role in Supernatural, then you moved?
Oh, no, I came over first, and then, I signed on with my agent, and I started auditioning straight away for film and TV, and I just decided to focus on film and television, and, so the role, this was the first time I'd auditioned for Supernatural. I auditioned for a few other local productions. I was in Psych. I filmed Psych middle of last year. This was another guest star. And, just the stuff of auditioning. It takes a little bit of time when you're in a new town for casting directors to get to know who you are. And obviously, because I come from a theatre background, there's a little bit of adjustment, I think, for camera work.
Oh, yeah.
Because I hadn't done as much of that.
Big time. Do you find that transition difficult going from, because with theater, for those that don't know, it's a lot more gestures, a lot more acting.
Dynamic.
You're actually putting yourself out there a lot. You're moving a lot more, and you have to play to the people in the cheap seats, in the back. And whereas with television, you got to be a little more subtle. Did you find that transition difficult, or did you find yourself being a natural?
Yeah, I think you can probably be as good a judge of that as me, really, and tell me what you think of the performance. I don't know, really. I mean, I think there's a school of thought in England that, American actors, North American actors are better at film because they grow up thinking in terms of film performance. And a lot of British actors come from the theatre and then have to adjust down, sort of like minimise their work, minimise their style, become more subtle. But I think I quite like the theatrical. For me, you're always acting with your whole body. And I think it's a skill to be able to act just from the shoulders up.
Right.
But I like acting with my whole body because it's more enjoyable for me.
Mm-hmm.
I like to feel like I'm really going through what I'm going through. And in theatre, it's kind of easier to do that because you start the show at 7:30 p.m. and you don't come out of the world until 10 p.m. You're in the world the whole time. So in a way, it's easier to tell the story. In film, the biggest challenge it is a challenge to make your performance smaller, but it's not as much of a challenge as it is doing the same performance over and over again, 10 times within an hour, on one page of action.
Yeah.
That is the skill. You've got to hit the ground running, really, every single time. And there's no one there saying, are you ready to go? But no, it's like there's 100 people on set, and when they're ready, you've got to be ready,
you know?
Now, where would you put voice acting for video games? Because you've done that before with Assassin's Creed and The Witcher 2. Would you put that, because it's just your voice, as you know, more challenging, just easier? How do you view that?
I see that as being it has its own challenges because you're really trying to test the toolbox of your voice and take yourself into different sound directions and stuff. So it is a challenge in its own way, but it's also just a complete pleasure because for the only time as an actor, you get to not care at all about how you look or how you're perceived. You're not worried about what people think of your physical appearance. So I love going into the studio dressed in my frack suit, it's like three day beard, and just having a microphone in front of you and just.
So you're saying you walk into auditions looking like Tony Soprano. You're wearing that
I try my best to go into auditions looking like the person that I'm supposed to be,
yeah.
I suppose.
Yeah, and that makes sense. I want to get into this auditioning a little bit more. Like, do you hate – everyone knows that auditioning is just – for a lot of actors, it's kind of pain. It's painful. Even if you enjoy performing – I mean, I remember there was an interview years ago. I forgot what actor it was, but he said – audition tapes belong in the trash the minute you walk out of that room. And this guy was a brilliant actor. And he says, it doesn't matter. He says, does not show how good you act. Some people can audition the shit for you, but then they can't perform when the camera's actually on them and they're rolling. So do you find, are you an audition guy or are you not an audition guy? Do you kind of loathe the auditions?
Wow, that's a lot of really good questions. In one, really. I mean, I like to think that I'm more of a do the job guy than an audition guy because I like to think that I'm always growing. You know, like you get the script. I mean, often you'll get the script 1-2 days before the audition,
yeah.
And you're expected to completely embody it and get really develop a relationship with it. One of the lessons I suppose I learned from a great actor from the theatre that I worked with in England, who's called Jeffrey Kissoon. If you get the chance to look him up, he's a legend of the stage. He's one of my favorite actors that I've worked with. Was that you have to be ready to give you got to peak at the right time. You know, you've got to peak when the camera's rolling and either you've got your close up or you've got however you choose to share the performance. You need to peak at that moment, not during the audition. And that works for me because I find auditions a very artificial environment. You're not there, in a sense, to do the job. You're there to procure the job. Right. You need to win the contract. You know, it's almost like a sales pitch, in a sense. That's what it is. You're saying, this is me and this is how I will do this. Mm-hmm. And then you've got to be super confident, even though they don't know you, these people. Yeah. I think once you get a degree of fame and profile, maybe the pressure is less. But I've heard from very famous actors who I've known that the pressure to perform in auditions never goes away because every actor, I think, on some level, if they're being honest, feels that fear of one day everyone's going to realize I'm not as good as they think I am. You know, they're going to realize I'm a big phony. You know, this is where I get found out. You know, you probably heard that. So every single time I go into the room, I think, have I made the right choices for this character? I don't know. But for these 5 minutes, I need to act as if all my choices are correct. You know, I need to win this.
Yeah. Do you have any stinkers out there that you know that you hope they burn the tapes? Like, is there some things that you know that you just bombed? You're like, please, God, never enter the light. Like, you're going to blow up. You're going to get put on Supernatural, and then all of a sudden some jackass is going to release your audition tape on YouTube.
Well, you know, the thing is, I've been an actor since I was about 22, since I graduated from drama school, and I think some of the stuff I did on actual short films and stuff in my early 20s is stuff that I don't want to see the light of day. So that wasn't even in auditions. That was already probably in the public realm somewhere. So I have to just hope that people are kind and just quietly murder those things in some dark alley somewhere. I don't worry about it, really, because I think you've got to be robust and have a thick enough skin to sort of say, whatever people present, you know, there's so many. I mean, if you see, even my hero, Daniel Day-Lewis, is one of the great actors of all time. Obviously, everybody knows that. He's got 3 Oscars. But, I think the guy's a really interesting study case because when he was early in his career, he was experimenting with styles, but some of his work, to me, wasn't a success. It was awful, actually.
Yeah.
And I would say that, maybe he wouldn't agree, maybe he would, I don't know. But the fact is, I would acknowledge that some of my work was awful. I mean, I've had even my mother tell me after a play, I don't know what you were doing there. I don't know. It made me despair of your acting career because I've never seen you so bad.
Thanks, Mom.
You know? And I was like, it's like even your mother says that, you know, it's like gutting you. I was just like, you know. So when you've got to be honest with yourself and say sometimes you take a risk and it doesn't come off. So I don't think that audiences are very forgiving. They want to believe what they're watching.
Yeah.
If you help them to do that, you've succeeded, and they'll forget your failures. Yeah. So I have to believe that, really.
It's a weird thing, the whole auditioning thing, because even if they know that you would be right for the role, you got to play the game. I mean, I've done casting for films, and it's hard. Like, that's not the job I prefer to do, because a few times, it's very unprofessional of me, a few times I had to snicker a little bit. I'm like, oh, God. And I'm like, I laughed because one time I was trying to cast this role of an assassin, and this guy just came in and he wanted every role. So what he did is he started performing every role at that time. He was Smeagol from Lord of the Rings. He was he was actually doing, oh, we could kill the fat one. And then, oh, Smeagol says no. Like, he was like actually going back and forth as if he was two characters. And we didn't know what we had to look down because he was trying. At one point, he found himself on the ground, strangling himself because he was killing the other guy that he was portraying.
And oh.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, I mean, have you heard stories of like this in your circles? Like, just people who go way out on the limb because they think that's what the casting directors want to see in the directors?
Well, I mean, I was pretty lucky, and I should mention this place because, you know, I owe them a lot. My drama school, the Oxford School of Drama in Britain, I went there from 2002 to 2005. Mm-hmm. And as part of the training is, you know, what not to do.
Yeah.
And we had a lot of casting directors and people from the industry, directors who were sat in castings. And we would, you know, we would get a lot of training on how to really not embarrass ourselves, you know, how to sort of operate within the boundaries of good taste, you know. But I actually have an example from my own early career where I was auditioning in a room, and it was one of those horrible, it was a theatre audition, but it was a horrible format because the ten auditionees were all in a line at the back of the room, and one by one we had to come forward and perform on our audition the person sat behind the table. And so all the auditionees are in a line, and we're looking up and down the line thinking, this is so awful, because we're all super self-conscious and really embarrassed and sort of, you know, which I think is an awful way to do it, because then the pressure is just outrageous. And this guy, it was a production of, it was a Shakespeare production, and this young guy got up and I think he did a Puck monologue from Midsummer Night's Dream.
Uh-huh.
And it's this really playful, rhyming, you know, speech.
Mm-hmm.
My mistress with a monster is in love, la 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 la, you know. And he got out this mask, put it over his face, and held this mask on his face whilst throwing himself bodily around the room and doing this monologue. And he was almost like trying to simulate as if he was on strings and being sort of swung through the air. And you couldn't understand what he said, and his hand was over his mouth as he held this mask on. And I was just like, what the hell are we watching here? Like, everyone in the room was looking at each other, and as you said, you know, like trying not to laugh. But then, you know, after the audition, I went out and chatted to the guy, and he was like, I was all stressed and pressured and worried about how I did and all that. And he was just like, so relaxed. He was just like, I just love being able to be there. I just love being able to audition. And I was like, oh my, I felt so humbled because I just thought, here's me thinking, I really, really, really want this job and I'll be embarrassed if I don't get it.
Yeah.
And this guy's like, you know, he's just happy to be in the game.
Yeah.
And I've always remembered that too, because it's like, you know, some of the people who have the most fun, yeah, maybe they're doing something that isn't ever going to get them the job, but they're enjoying themselves, you know, and that's kind of like the point. So I think with auditions, you've got to enjoy yourself, because then you're immune to criticism. You're just like, think about me whatever you want. I'm here, this is my job, and I love my job. You know, I could be working in a factory, and I have done that, and I don't want to do that anymore. Mm. I want to be here. So, you know, anyway.
I get it. Now, first off, first question, we'll keep this one simple and short. Did you, and be honest, you don't have to make up stories for us, but like, were you a fan of Supernatural? Did you watch it at all? Did you know of it? Or was it kind of out of your realm? Like, you're like, I didn't really pay attention to it.
Well, I knew of it, obviously, because it's just, you know, it's a massive show.
Yeah.
I especially got to know more about it when I moved to Vancouver, beginning of 2013. My friend was in it, He played. He was in. His name's Ollie Rice. He trained at the same school as me. He was in Everybody Hates Hitler.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Playing the fool demon, the fool necromancer.
Yes.
I talked about that when he was working on that, and we really discussed the show. And then I started watching, you know, episodes here and there. So I would watch like a few episodes from different seasons. Mm-hmm. I watched the pilot. I watched the first few episodes of the first season. Then I started watching from the background to the new seasons. It's amazing actually how different, you know, once you catch it in a sequence of three or four in different seasons, it's amazing how different it is.
Yeah.
But I haven't watched it from the beginning to the end.
You were aware that obviously that Supernatural was big. So when you got the part that you got, you know, playing a very important character's son, okay, and the fact that I look at it a couple different ways. They already had his son in the show back in season six. They recast him for a reason, you know. And again, we're just gonna we've already speculated. We don't need to speculate with you because we don't want to get you in trouble. However, as I said before, don't say anything if you are going to be in it next year. Don't say anything.
This is a contractment or something. Is there anything that I can do here? If I had a lawyer, I'd be saying that. Obviously I can't say anything about it. I like to think that they cast me because I'm someone who they could trust long term.
Exactly.
Who knows? But at the end of the day,
that's the first thing I thought of it, Theo. Like when I saw that what character you were playing, and that they went, because usually they don't recast characters; they usually bring them back continually. And I'm like, okay, there's a reason, you know. And I, that's just me speculating, Theo. I mean, just you know, you don't have to say yes or no; just nod your head no.
I would never ever compare myself to another actor. Anyway.
I understand.
Terribly bad taste on my part.
And we're not saying nothing about his talents because I don't remember them, quite frankly. But the fact that, you know, obviously they saw something in you and they wanted to recast him and put you in there. So, and that's good. You know, it's good news for you. However, now being put into something like this, were you a little stressful about maybe the audience feedback? Because if you were on an episode of like Matlock, let's say it's on, no one's going to care. You know, no one's going to care if you're playing opposite of Andy Griffith and you suck and they don't like you. No one's going to care. There's no Twitter trolls. But... when you're on Supernatural, which is a huge, you know, especially online, it has a huge fandom.
Very passionate.
Were you a little stressful? Were you a little stressed out getting on Twitter during the episode and afterwards, kind of seeing, you know, are people going to attack me? Like, were you a little stressed out?
I wouldn't say I was stressed out. I mean, it's kind of like, as I say, if I was probably a lot less experienced than if I was right at the beginning of my career, I would probably be more concerned about people's opinion of me as an actor.
Yeah.
What I was more concerned about was, quite frankly, whether the people who have the ownership of this show, the fans and the people who followed it and supported it, whether they would be satisfied with my representation of the character who, as you say, is really close to Crowley, who's beloved, you know. I didn't want people to be like, oh, what a letdown, you know? Because I read the script. Actually, when I read the script, I didn't know who Gavin was because I wasn't familiar with his story. Even in the script, it wasn't obvious who he was, you know, who he was related to. So I just tried to honor what was written. I knew that in the script there was a real interesting mixture of humor, of vulnerability, of hope and sort of strength of character that this kid had suffered, that he felt legitimate resentment towards his father. These are all stories that are universal themes that could belong to any character.
Yeah.
My job was simply to honor what the writers had written, and I think quite well, a nice balance of a character who's angry and he's hurt, but who isn't sort of just sort of twisted up by the experience too badly. You know, he hasn't become an evil character.
Right.
He hasn't become hateful.
You're fresh off the boat, naive kind of guy.
Yeah. You know, I just tried to honor as it was written, and I thought that if I did a decent job of that, that people would forgive me if it was not what they wanted to see. And, you know, I think the writers are the ones who decide. I just tried to do my job.
Yeah.
You know? But I was I'm concerned because I'm up against, you know, Mark Shepard as Crowley, who's like every minute's a tour de force. You know, the man's got wit, charisma, he's hilariously funny, he's also dark. You know, there's so much in his character that people can really enjoy and get their teeth into. And he's been there for like 5 seasons and like he's really developed. So I wanted to come in hard and strong and be like, okay, I'm not going to let you dominate this story because I'm your son and you treat me like crap. And now it's my turn to tell my story. You know?
Yeah.
It's like, you've been reveling in the glory. Who do you think you are? None of these people know you like I know you. Do you see what I mean? So I had to own the story of my character.
Yeah.
So do
you get a little competitive? Because I've, like, I've worked with actors. Not competitive in a bad way. Not competitive in a bad way, but competitive, like, say, like you were just saying, how I'm working with Mark Shepard here. Like, do you start feeling like, do you feel competitive, meaning do you feed off his charisma and his presence? Do you use that to catapult yourself to even better acting abilities during when the camera's rolling?
I would definitely try to do that. I mean, whether you succeed or not is another question, but you know, it's always, you know, you go into any situation where you're working with people like Elena or Mark, and I wasn't doing much with Jared or Jensen,
right?
But with these, you know, with Elena and Mark, these guys are like very, very accomplished screen actors.
You know,
they've got chops. So obviously, I want to draw from their experience and sort of try and bounce off them, use their charisma.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. What a fabulous time! I mean, honestly, you're in a room pretty much with Mark Shepard and Elena Huffman. Is that how you say her last name, Huffman? Yeah,
I believe so.
Like it's. I mean, that's just a comfortable situation as well, that you're in that one, pretty much that one set, just working back and forth with them. That's just an enjoyable time. I'm extremely jealous of you, Theo.
Oh, thanks. You know, I like
because you got close to Abaddon.
Almost got the kiss range you wanted, Mike.
Well, Elena put her hands on my face.
I'm so jealous of you right now.
That was enough for me. specifically, the first day, I mean, I don't think there's any problem with me sharing this. We, as you know, obviously always film things out of sequence.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
we filmed the final scene where, you know, Gavin says goodbye to his dad and, you know, Crowley dismisses him and basically says, you know, that's it for us. Mm-hmm. We did that the first day. And everyone was running over. We had, like, you know, the crew had been out in the rain, you know, all day. And everyone was kind of like, right, we've got to get this done sort of thing. And I just arrived on set. I'd been in my trailer for a few hours. Mark, I saw maybe half an hour before we went on to shoot. So here you are thinking, you know, that's a nightmare for me. Because I'm like, what, you know, I'm new to the set. I'm new to this story. I'm new to this show. I'm new to this character. And I've got to do the big goodbye, you know, first, before I'd even had a chance to, like, you know, get to know Mark or anything. And the fact is, Mark Shepard, as well as being a really accomplished actor, is also a top, top man.
Yeah.
And he just, you know, he didn't act. You know, this kind of competitiveness between the actors, it can be a really positive thing. You know, it can be a really positive thing.
And
sometimes people clash, but me and Mark just, you know, immediately got on like a house on fire, and he just so loved his job. He so cared about the story, and he just helped me out. You know, he was there for me, and we rehearsed, we did it. He gave me, you know, not tips, because actors don't really give each other tips, per se, but like he just made me feel at home, because, you know, coming into a new show, you are trying to not only tell the story of your character like you are in any story, not only trying to just be watchable and, you know, appealing and share your lines, your movements and that sort of stuff. You're also trying to get the tone of the show right. Because every show has its own tone. You know, some are obviously comedies. Some are obviously high drama. Some is Shakespeare. I mean, Supernatural has humor. It has drama. It has action. You know, it has, like, unbelievable set piece movements and stuff. So, like, I'm sort of trying to get all of that right. And so I was a little bit concerned about how that first day was going to go. But Mark made it easy. And he's a top guy as well as a top actor. So, pleasure to work with, really.
One thing that I'm a stickler for is a lot of times, and a lot of times my thing is, you know, especially inexperienced actors, which you guys are not. Like a lot of times, acting is acting to me is the face and what you put off. It's not what you say. It's your mannerisms, your body language, and one thing that I thought that you sold was the disbelief, because when you deal with somebody, I've always hated that in TV shows and movies, where the acceptance of holy shit, there's a hot redhead putting something on my door. Like, what the hell is this? Like, you had sincere disbelief. Like, you were frightened, but not out of your mind, like, you know, the Three Stooges crazy hitting each other over the head. But you were, but the disbelief was subtle. And you didn't oversell it, and you didn't undersell it. I think where you went with it was just enough to give us that inciting incident for the opening 5 minute teaser. And I thought it was brilliant. You know, just me giving you a little bit of kudos there, because that's one thing I hate in television and movies is you'll have something completely unrealistic happen in a world. You know, you're in the 1600s, and there needs to be that disbelief if someone just appeared in front of you. So go ahead.
Well, thank you. Yeah, thank you. We're looking pleased. Yeah, thank you. I'm glad that you feel it read that way. So I hope everyone feels the same way you do.
Oh, I'm sure they do. I speak for everybody.
I have to say, you know, I was trained in method acting, among other styles of you know, so it's pretty hard to method your way into, okay, a massive light started to appear behind my cabin door, and then this cunning redhead just marches through and then starts chanting into my face after killing my mate in a really gruesome way. It's sort of like, where's your trigger for that? It's like, oh no, nothing in my childhood. No, I can't really remember anything quite like that happening. So you just try and think, like, okay, this is shit scary, but also I've got to make it kind of watchable. I can't just be, like you say, hysterical with fear.
Right.
So I tried to walk that line, so I'm glad. Thank you. I'm glad you.
It did. It came off very well. I'm actually very happy. And moving on to the next question, that makes me happy with, you know. And I know you can't talk about certain things, but that makes me happy that they cast you. I think you were a good fit. The chemistry was there with the rest of the cast, and I think that if they continue to use your character, which, again, this is just me and Thomas spitballing right now.
Right.
Like, if they were to use you, I mean, they don't bring you on, make a point to say, hey, oh, you're messing with the ripple effect. They don't do all that stuff and set you up if they don't plan on using you. So for me and the rest of the audience, we're excited, and we're just speculating here, Theo. But, like, if you were to also speculate, let's say, like, what would you – I'm not saying you – if you can talk about this – what would you like to see if your act character did continue? Okay, not saying it is or it's not, but what would you like to see Theo progress? Like, would you like him to see him be bad?
Embrace that Prince of Hell kind of thing, or go down a completely different route from where Crowley did and try and be the opposite of his dad? Where would you like to see it go?
Well, you are very tempting here with these conversations. because obviously, I've thought a lot about it. Because I've thought a lot about, as the character, I'm, you know, during the scenes that you've seen, you know, as the actor, you're trying to visualize a future that the character wants more than any other, because that helps you to drive through the moments of the action. You're thinking, okay, what's happening here that's helping me get to where I want to go? You have to have a clear sight of where you want to go. And one of the things about Gavin is that one minute he's like completely excited about the future and completely motivated and supremely free and euphoric. The next minute he's devastated and convinced that his whole life is just going to hell in a handcar, you know, with no weather. He's just spinning off wildly. So, like, you know, in a sense, you know, it's kind of a he really could go in any direction. I mean, you know, and it could be really satisfying any direction he decides, you know, the writers decide to take him. Because, you know, as we all know, like, believably, with his psychology, he could become very hateful, very, very grim, very dark.
Easily.
Just as easily as he could decide to leave all of his kind and just try and have, like, a really normal life. You know, people who've had really unstable young lives try to have really normal lives sometimes.
Right.
If they're able to do that, if they're able to retain the stability, or they meet someone who helps them to be stable. But then the path always seems to come back. I think with Gavin, I think that's kind of the big story in some ways, is that the past keeps coming back. Who he is, right. You know, he might try to get away. I mean, the fact is, he was on his way to the new world. Why? Because he was trying to escape himself, his past. And, you know, he wants to make a new life for himself. He's motivated by that, by starting afresh, starting again. I like the idea of him being someone who's kind of always trying to create new beginnings, mm-hmm. and then they keep getting somehow thwarted. I mean, I do think that, you know, I mean, I'm trying to be careful here because you can't shut any door.
Well,
there's so many good possibilities.
There is, and but
I'm doing my best here. See, I'm really doing my best here, Mike.
And I'll do a little disclaimer here, and I'll help you out here. Like, listen, we're not saying anything that Jeremy Carver himself hasn't said at the Comic-Con a year and a half ago. He said that he's writing these scripts for the next 3 years with unlimited possibilities. Like, so if he feels like he wants to go this direction, okay. And he's basically throwing stuff at walls, and hopefully it'll stick. And if it sticks and the fans like it, they'll go with it. So, again, there's your disclaimer.
Well, thank you. So I'll be a little bit more bold then in my answer. what I would say about Gavin is that what I like about the character the most is that he has this incredible range of emotion. So we've only seen one episode, you're introduced. Like, I'm never going to be able to bring the kind of detail and subtlety that say, Mark has been able to earn now after so many years on the show. But I want an opportunity to share a lot of the subtle shades of this character, because I can feel them in myself. A lot of them are personal tragedies and the things not coming off that you want to happen. Then there are things of, like, temptations into dark behavior. I even saw that in the episode. There's this thing of, I can do anything I want, no matter my sins. Mm. You will protect me from eternally burning. You know, it's that thing of, like, wow. I mean, in a sense, how I feel about Gavin is how Gavin now feels about his life. It's like anything is possible. Yeah. You know, on the one hand, I've got this, like, career in, like, evil royalty. On the other hand, I could go, as, you know, I've speculated, and open an antiquarian bookshop. You know, because I love reading, and I'm from the past, so I'm, you know, I'll be able to date things, you know, accurately or whatever. But I think the key thing that Gavin retains is his fundamental character, which is that there's this optimism, this hope for the future, and this boldness.
And that's what we got, and that's why I think you portrayed that pretty well. Because even, like, going back with what you were just saying was, like, when you – it's weird because you could see how you could easily be tempted by dark secrets or dark power, just like Crowley. Because first you were appalled when he says, what, you sold your soul for an extra 3 inches on your cock? You know, like, or whatever you said. Obviously you didn't say cock. You were appalled by it, that he would do something like that. But then when you found out, you know, like you were saying, you were, you know, some dark royalty, does that make me the prince of hell? You got a little extra skip in your step, and you got a little happy there.
Yeah.
I think he wants to feel good about himself. You know, someone who wants something very simple to feel good about himself. A lot of people don't require that because they don't have this thing of, like, people who have bad childhoods, like him, who, you know, frankly, beaten up by his dad.
Yeah.
They've got a pretty low opinion of themselves, usually. I think Gavin has a pretty low opinion of himself. But through his behavior, he can try to win a high opinion of himself. And that's his story, essentially. Yeah. And that's what's dangerous, is that he's a volatile ego. You know, someone who can go in multiple directions. You know, but then, again, I don't know. I mean, it's hard to know because everything's conjecture.
Oh, yeah.
You know, what would be most interesting. But I would like to see him cast a really broad journey. You know, I'm speaking hopefully here. A really broad journey between sort of his affable, gentle, you know, his, in a sense, his innocent soul.
Yeah.
And then the most, you know, the darkest temptations, mm-hmm. you know. Something like, you know, something kind of Hamlet-esque.
It's exciting, man. It's an exciting, it's an exciting, I bet you it was an exciting time for you as well. You know, there's so many possibilities. Yeah. And going on to that, segueing over to that, like, do you have any other upcoming projects that you're working on? Do you have any films, other TV work that you're doing right now?
Yeah, I've got a couple of indie things coming up. One is a film called Becoming Sophie, which is a short film that's being directed by Crystal Lowe, who's another actor who lives she divides the time between LA and Vancouver, but she's an actor who's directing for the first time, and I'm playing a lead in that shooting next week, just a 4-day shoot. And that's a little indie short. I'm filming Night at the Museum this week as well.
Wait, you're doing which one?
Night at the Museum I'm doing as well this week.
The sequel, or is that
the number 3, yeah.
Really? Yeah. That's a biggie, dude.
Yeah, it's good. It's all nice.
Right, my man. First, you got some of that Night in the Museum Ben Stiller cash in your pocket now.
Well, not yet. I mean, they haven't paid me. I haven't done it yet. So.
No, okay, come on. That's why you were out last night. Come on. You were celebrating it up.
No. Actually, I was casting that in December. So
really?
This is how long these things take. Yeah, I think features, they tend to cast very early, and then you shoot, you know, after a long time. So I'm shooting that this week as well. And
that's
then,
awesome.
How many days on set will you be for Night of the Museum?
One or two, not certain, but okay. I think I'm just doing one on Wednesday. It's a kind of, it's a cameo. There's like lots of characters from the past, I believe it's fair to say.
I'll be playing Gavin MacLeod.
Well, no, I'm getting for a bit of range, you know. I'm getting a bit of range. It's a bit of a departure for me.
You're going to get typecast already. No.
Although, you know, Gavin, if you're going to get typecast as a character, Gavin's a pretty good character to get typecast as, because, you know, he's funny, he's sort of likable, and he's also kind of tragic in his own way as well.
Let's look at your diversity. Let's audition you right now, Theo.
Oh, God. Okay,
you on our pre-interview / discussion we had on Wednesday, you actually made it a point to talk about your accent, you know, British or Scottish. Right. Now, right now, what you've been talking to us with, that's your natural accent. That's British, correct?
Yeah, pretty much.
English?
Would
you call it an English accent or a British accent?
I call it an English accent.
Okay, English
really.
Accent.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but I mean, it's kind of what we have in England is countless dialects. Yeah. All over the
right.
Like many more than you have in North America. Many, many more.
Would you call yourself are you a Hugh Grant? Or are you a hold on, bear with me. What was the other name, Maggie, I had?
Russell Brand.
Yeah. Are you a Hugh Grant type of Englishman or a Russell Brand type of Englishman?
I was a Hugh Grand, I would call myself. Someone in between. All
right.
Or a Rue Grand. A Rue Grand. Yeah. Which is French for large road, whatever that means. I think I'm a bit of both because, I mean, I'm definitely not as middle class, upper middle class as Hugh Grant. I don't have that kind of like cut glass, you know, very posh public school background. Mm. But, you know, I come from a very working class family. But I've sort of a bit more, I suppose, I just don't know really. It's so hard. I think in England there's so many, I mean, there is a strong caste system in England, so sometimes you see someone like Hugh Grant, who's very one thing, and then you see Russell Brand, who seems to very much represent working class Londoners.
Right.
But most people are somewhere in between, you know, so I'm probably somewhere in between. I like to think of myself as a bit of a Russell Brand sometimes, when the mood takes me. But then I like to think of myself as a Hugh Grant sometimes, you know, when I'm drinking in bars in Vancouver. So, you know, it's sort of, yeah, it's a bit of both, really, I would say, in between.
Now,
and I'm a kind of character actor. I don't want to be, you know, I don't really want to be pigeonholed. Sorry, you finish. You carry on now.
It's all right. Let's give you, do you remember your lines at all from Supernatural? Do you remember them still?
I'm sure I do, yeah.
Okay,
sure do.
Give us a monologue of sorts, or your sides. You can go over your sides if you have them. But give us I want to hear an American accent. I want to hear your version of an American accent.
Right. I thought you were going to make me do Scottish like you
nope.
said you were.
Oh, come
we've
on.
Heard
no.
that.
That's,
we've heard that
that's
one.
Too easy, man.
We've heard that one.
Okay.
Listen.
Well, actually, before I try the American, which usually I have time to prepare.
Cold read.
I will
cold
just say that on Twitter I have been, I've been speaking to a lot of Scottish people who... some of whom say, nice try, it was Scottish. Or they say, that was an awful Scottish, but I liked the episode anyway.
I'm going to help you out. You said your method, correct? So let's give you a little help here, okay? Okay. Pretend I am, let's say, who's a big director right now? Let's see.
Right now?
Yeah, Michael Bay.
Okay. Oh, okay. Jesus.
Gosh.
Michael Bay.
You went there.
Hey, listen, you know what? The work will be, you know, what do you guys call it? Shat? It'll be, is that you guys call it? It'll be shit work, but the paycheck will get you laid, okay?
Oh, my God. So, oh, my God.
So listen, I'm Michael Bay, and you need to give me, I need to hear your American accent, but I really liked, listen, Theo, I really liked your role in Supernatural. You know, I have something similar, but I want you to use an American accent and action.
I can't be consorting with a demon. That would make me a witch. I could be burned at the stake.
Wow.
How's that?
That was
good.
That
was awesome.
Not bad.
Not bad.
You're not John Wayne.
Okay.
You're not John Wayne. Yeah, Theo, you're not John Wayne, because I have a lot of English friends, British friends, and they all, like, when they try to make fun of me, like, oh, I'm an American, like, they make me sound like I'm John Wayne. I'm like, dude, we don't all sound like John Wayne, just like you guys don't all sound like Hugh Grant.
Or the guy with the California version.
We're not Valley Girls.
But every single friend of mine, and I'll be honest, three British friends. I don't have a British fetish. I mean, I don't just hang out with British people.
Sure.
But I mean, I have several British friends, and a lot of them all just assume that we like their go-to is the John Wayne. I'm like, no, dude, it's not. Let's not do John Wayne. That's not. Come on, you really think we sound like John Wayne? And so you try to change it, and then they start sounding like a cross between John Wayne and Christian Bale from Batman. So
exactly. Well, Christian Bale is he's British. He's as British as they come. Right? He's from Wales.
Yeah, but Christian Bale from with the non-accent when he doesn't lose it in Batman. Sometimes he loses it.
Yeah.
But,
does he?
Yeah. Oh,
well,
yeah,
if he can lose it, then I can lose it.
Yeah.
I always think, like, there are so many bad accents across the board.
Mm-hmm.
There's so many, you know, there's so much film with people doing bad accents that I just try to take the pressure off myself. I just wait for somebody to say, okay, that's no good. We gotta reshoot that. And that's fine.
It's amazing that, you know, I don't think a lot of people catch it, but, you know, because I'm just attuned, I'm one of those people who just watch everything on a show. Me and Thomas Bolden, actually, we pick things apart. Not negatively, but we just watch things, and I notice a lot. There's a lot of actors who are doing an American accent for a movie. Who in an intense scene, like if they're yelling, or slip out. Colin Farrell, he's one of them.
Yeah,
like he does that American accent really well. I like him. He's one of I think he's an underrated actor, but he does every once in a while he'll slip into that Irish accent.
Also, does Charlie Hunnam.
So there's other examples. I mean, Russell Crowe is, I don't think anyone's going to contend that Russell Crowe is one of the best actors out there.
Right.
You know, the man's a force of nature, right? I mean, have you seen the remake of 3:10 to Yuma?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I actually had a serious man crush on him in that film, and that's even his best performance.
You know,
I mean, he is funny, scary at the same time.
Oh,
but then when he did an interview in England, in the lead up to Robin Hood, and he did his sort of, they were like, you've got an interesting accent in this one, Russell. You're kind of a sort of Scottish, Irish, English, Welsh, Nordic. And he just walked out before the sentence, he walked out of the interview Because, you know, everybody, sometimes as an actor, you try things, and no one on set was going to tell Russell Crowe, you're sounding a little bit north of the river there, Russell. You might want to pull it back a bit, you know. No one's going to do that.
Yeah.
So it's hard for those guys. They're superstars. Like, people are scared of them.
That's exactly. Like, usually that's what you do. When you're hiring a name like Russell Crowe, you're gonna hire them and you're gonna let them go. There's gonna be very little directing involved with them.
Very few directors will take that stance.
Yeah. I mean, especially if you're working with Ed Norton, he's one of those guys. But she's brilliant.
He's amazing.
He's one of those guys who usually takes over the film from the director.
right, yeah.
But if you do it the right way and you help the film, sometimes you hear negative things about those people. But to me, Ed Norton is a brilliant actor, and he usually makes movies for the better. I mean, I don't want to ruin your chances in Hollywood, but I mean, I loathe Brett Ratner. I think he's a terrible director. But for some reason, Ed Norton, you know, pops up on Red Dragon, the prequel to Hannibal, and that movie didn't even seem like a Brett Ratner movie. I'm like, yeah, because it was Ed Norton movie. He directed it.
Yeah. Right.
He said, "Here, Brett, you just collect the check, and I'm going to direct this."
I think it's. I think you know, in my very, very limited experience of filmmaking and watching films being made. I mean, it's a pretty hard thing logistically to pull together. It seems to me that if a film is a success, it's kind of a small miracle. You produce, I gather, you produce work, don't you? Produce film.
Well, yeah.
I mean, you know how many things, a million things have to go right for a film to be a success. And, you know, once you bring in mega power millionaire egos into the bargain, it's going to be hard because everyone's got an opinion. There could be multiple correct opinions, you know? So, I mean, if you're someone like Ed Norton who's got this massive brain and, and super talented, I think it's hard for him to go, oh, I'm just going to let this one go. Sort of like, no, I'm doing this for 6 months of my life. I want it to be the best it can be.
Yeah. Exactly.
So I think it's a pitfall when you get to that level. I think it becomes harder to let go.
Well, Theo, we will let you go. We've kept you on a little longer than I wanted. I apologize, but thank you.
It's been fun.
Thank you for being a sport and letting us play around with your American accent a little bit.
No worries. This is why I enjoy this stuff. I do it for a living. It's fun, you know?
Great, man. So, and you know what? We'll get you on the line again, hopefully, if you're willing, down the road, all right?
Yeah, I'd be glad to. Nice to meet you guys. Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much, Theo.
Thank you.
Thank you. You have a great weekend.
You too. Take care.
All right, guys, we want to thank you again for listening to us today. Once again, check us out on Stitcher and iTunes, Twitter, Facebook, Google+, all of that stuff. Leave us a review if you can. That will help us get a lot more views and push us out there even farther. Tell your friends. And again, we want to thank you. Have a good night.
You little maggot. You are no longer a part of this story. Hey, ass butt.